Okay, we're going to call the Board of Mayor and Aldermen meeting for April 26, 2022 to order. Roll call, Alderman Peterson.
Here.
Alderman Hanson.
Here.
Alderman Barnhill.
Here.
Vice Mayor Blanton.
Here.
Alderman Berger.
Here.
Alderman Brown.
Here.
Alderman Potts.
Present.
And Alderman Baggett.
Present.
And the mayor is present also. We'll begin tonight with an invocation. I would ask that Alderman Barnhill lead us in that. As he leads that invocation, I would ask that, number one, he remember the Gentry family. We all know that Jimmy Gentry was a local hero, a war hero, a hero because he mentored so many young men, young people, children, and even adults in his life, and also the people of Ukraine. So, Alderman Barnhill, and I'd ask everybody to stand, and then I'll lead the Pledge of Allegiance after that.
Would you bow, please? Heavenly Father, we come to you in prayer tonight, thanking you for this great nation that we live in and for this opportunity that we have of meeting here tonight. We know that there are many countries where strife and where war and where other issues exist, that they don't have these freedoms. We thank you for them. We ask your blessings upon those, on the soldiers and on those first responders who protect our freedoms. Also, Heavenly Father, tonight we ask your blessings upon the Gentry family. We know that they are suffering. We know that we have lost an icon in the community, and we pray for the family as they go forward with their grieving and the process that they go through. We also ask your prayer upon the citizens of Ukraine. We ask you prayer that we know that there are hardships, unbelievable hardships, that we here have no idea how hard they are. We ask your blessings upon them. This prayer we offer to you in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. Join me in the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please be seated. Next item on the agenda is an opportunity for citizens to make comments for items that are not on the agenda. My staff is... Okay, great, thank you. I have no speaker cards for items not on the agenda, but I have plenty for items that are on the agenda tonight. I have no communications for the Williamson County Commission. I have been told that we have two birthdays tonight, or upcoming birthdays, from Alderman Brown and Alderman Baggett.
And Alderman Peterson was a week ago.
And then Alderman Peterson. So I guess that's a requirement that you have to have birthdays in April to be Alderman. So,
Mayor, I just appreciate all my neighbors coming out to wish me happy birthday.
Yeah.
Great part.
I don't think they're happy enough to sing.
Right. So,
we will now go to the minutes of April the 12th, work session and Board of Mayor and Alderman meeting. You've had those, and I would entertain a motion.
Move for approval.
Thank you, Alderman Peterson. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Alderman Barnhill. Let's call the roll then. Alderman Peterson.
Present.
Alderman.
Yes.
Was that a yes or a present?
Present.
Alderman Hanson.
Yes, and present.
We were asking...
We called the roll a minute ago, and then you were asking for a yes on approval of the minutes?
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you. Alderman Barnhill.
Yes.
Vice Mayor Blanton.
Ear and yes.
Alderman Berger.
Yes.
Alderman Brown.
Yes.
Alderman Potts.
Yes.
And Alderman Baggett.
Yes.
Passes unanimously. There are now a couple of recognitions, I think, that we wanted to have tonight, and I'll ask Mr. Stuckey for those two that he had.
I do have a couple of recognitions. In addition to the BOMA Birthday Club that we recognized earlier, two folks that play an important role on our city team overall, but often at these meetings, want to recognize. Lisa Clayton, our Parks Director, just reached her 20th anniversary with the City of Franklin. Congratulations, Lisa. We all know child labor laws were different then, and we appreciate your service. And also, a man who is behind the scenes but does a remarkable job for us and is the reason you're able to track what's going on at these meetings many times and on social media, Robert Mott, who is the supervisor of Franklin TV and all things video. He has reached a 15-year milestone with the city, so we want to recognize Robert. Thank you, Robert. And I'll mention this and welcome anyone else on the board, especially one of our aldermen, if they want to add to this, but Police Officer Sean Finn is returning to Tennessee tomorrow afternoon. So, yes. His plane will land around 1:30 at BNA. Alderman Hansen played a particular role in helping facilitate that through an individual privately owned jet to get him home. We're not going to get to spend a lot of time with him because he is going to need to keep healing and getting better, but he's faced a mighty battle with COVID since right around Christmas, and we're just so thankful to have him back home and that he's in the right place in this battle. So we're just thrilled to have him come home, and I want to thank Alderman Hansen and many other citizens who helped make this possible and provide for this type of flight at this time. So.
I would like to add a special thank you to Ali Himyari, who's with K9 Nashville, and his location is in McKay's Mill, and he's a partner in Secure Air with John Sansko, I believe is his name. And they so generously donated this jet to go and get Officer Finn in Florida and bring him back, because travel was really hard with his compromised system after being under medical care for that long. So a huge thank you to them for making this officer's life much easier to return home.
Since we can't all be there in person, and probably shouldn't, we will broadcast on our social media platforms live his arrival back. We're going to have an escort from Franklin Police Motors, from our fire department, from our honor guard, the state highway patrol is going to be part of that as well, as we take him home and help him on his next step of his journey of healing. So you can tune in Facebook Live, whatever suits you, tomorrow afternoon if you want to see it. Thank you.
Okay, we have three proclamations. Does anybody else have any miscellaneous reports or recognition? Vice Mayor?
Yes, sir. We have, I don't know what annual it is. I know it's at least 12. Arbor Day this coming Saturday at Pinkerton Park. Middle Tennessee Electric has upped the ante from hot dogs to grilled cheese. If you need to plant a tree, we can help you out there. There'll be lots of activities for families. That starts at 10 in the morning and goes until 2. Lisa's shaking her head, yes.
Pinkerton.
We have run the gauntlet between cold, rain, no snow, but it proves to be a really pretty day, so we would love to have everybody out to Pinkerton Park from 10 to 2 for Arbor Day.
Thank you. The first proclamation I have tonight refers to fair housing. Kathleen Sosueta is going to come up. And whereas the City of Franklin, Tennessee actively and affirmatively promotes fair housing in its policies and practices, and whereas April 2022 marks the 54th anniversary of the 1968 Fair Housing Act, which strives to ensure equal housing opportunity for all, the law prohibits discrimination based on race, color, creed, national origin, sex, familial status, or handicap and applies to homeowners, landlords, mortgage lenders, and appraisers. Whereas for many families, homeownership is a stepping stone to prosperity and represents the American way of life. Fair housing means opening these doors for everyone in this country whose goal is to own a home. And whereas the Board of Mayor and Aldermen hereby designates April as the Fair Housing Month in the city of Franklin, Tennessee, and reaffirms its commitment to combating unlawful housing discrimination and encouraging the development of balanced residential living patterns, now therefore be it proclaimed that on this day, April 26, 2022, the Board of Mayor and Aldermen of the City of Franklin do hereby recognize and claim our dedication to the principles guaranteed under the Fair Housing Act for the existing residents and future generations. I hereunto set my hand this 26th day of April, 2022.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. The next one is Franklin Water Week.
Good.
Whereas... Perfect. Perfect. It's nice to have somebody accept it because it's kind of lonely up here. Whereas the Harpeth River is a precious community resource and the City of Franklin recognizes that its role as a steward of the environment is to deliver our high-quality services and to preserve the natural beauty of our community. And whereas stormwater runoff can become polluted and transported through municipal separate storm sewer systems, and this polluted runoff is then discharged in our local water resources. And whereas to protect citizens from this pollution, the City of Franklin has developed a stormwater program that seeks to manage stormwater and to prevent pollution before it enters the Harpeth River and its many tributaries. And whereas the City of Franklin has formed a partnership with Cumberland River Compact, a nonprofit organization with the goal of providing the public with the tools to be smart, impactful stewards of their watershed with an understanding that education, restoration, and public outreach all contribute to keeping our water resources healthy. Whereas it is in the public interest for the citizens, civic leaders, and children in the City of Franklin to gain knowledge of, to maintain a progressive interest, and to understand the importance of water quality and stormwater management in their respective communities. Now, therefore, I, Dr. Ken Moore, Mayor of the City of Franklin, do hereby proclaim May the 1st through the 7th, 2022, as Franklin Water Week in the City of Franklin, and I urge all citizens to celebrate local water resources, to learn about the importance of clean and abundant water, and to become environmental stewards for the watersheds within our community. That was a long one.
My name is Brittany Perez, and I'm a water quality specialist with the Engineering Stormwater Management Department.
I'm Haley Henderson with the Cumberland River Compact.
Great. Thank you. And now we have the 53rd Annual Professional Municipal Clerks Week coming up, and so... Linnea and Angie. Yeah. Whereas the Office of the Professional Municipal Clerk, time-honored and vital part of local government, exists throughout the world and is the oldest among public servants. Whereas the Office of the Professional Municipal Clerk provides the professional link between the citizens, the local governing bodies, and agencies of government at other levels. And whereas professional municipal clerks have pledged to be ever mindful of their neutrality and impartiality, rendering equal service to all. Whereas the professional municipal clerk serves as the information center on functions of local government and community. And whereas professional municipal clerks continually strive to improve the administration of the affairs of the office, professional municipal clerk through participation in education programs, seminars, workshops, and the annual meetings of their state, provincial, county, and international professional organizations, and whereas it is important, appropriate that we recognize the accomplishment of the office of the professional municipal clerk. Now, therefore, I, Dr. Ken Moore, Mayor of the City of Franklin, do hereby proclaim the week of May the 1st through the 7th, 2022, as Professional Municipal Clerks Week in the City of Franklin, and further extend appreciation to our professional municipal clerk recorders for the vital services they perform and their exemplary dedication to the communities they represent. Okay, we're going to go to the consent agenda. And as we go to the consent agenda, all those items are deemed to be non-controversial and routine in nature by the governing body, and they will be approved as recommended by committee or staff by one motion of the governing body. And tonight we're considering items number 12 through 23.
Mayor, I'd like to make a motion to pull item 19 for further discussion, please, from the consent agenda.
So your motion is to approve with removing 19 to the
meeting. Yes, approve the others, remove 19 for further discussion, please.
Perfect. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Alderman Barnhill. Any discussion? Ready to vote? Alderman Peterson.
Yes.
Alderman Hansen.
Yes.
Alderman Barnhill.
Is it present or yes? Yes.
Vice Mayor.
Yes, sir.
Alderman Berger.
Yes.
Alderman Brown.
Yes.
Alderman Potts.
Yes.
And Alderman Baggett.
Yes.
Passes unanimously. And I'm ready to go back up. Okay, item number five. And as I get ready to read this resolution and we take a vote, I do want to recognize that we do have the family of Supreme Court Justice Cornelia, or as I call her, Connie Clark, here tonight with us to celebrate this street naming. So this resolution, 2022-23, recognizes Cornelia Clark, the state's Supreme Court Justice, through the addition of honorary street signage along the length of 4th Avenue in the city of Franklin.
Move for approval.
Thank you, Vice Mayor. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Alderman Brown.
Hot.
It's his birthday. I'll give it to him.
Thank you. Alderman Potts. Sorry I didn't catch it. So, any discussion? Vice Mayor.
Not just discussion, but a comment. I apologize I wasn't here 2 weeks ago when this came up again, but I just think that it's a wonderful way to honor Connie and all that she's done in so many capacities for our community, and how wonderful it can be on 4th Avenue, where she spent her life living and unfortunately passing away, and she's honored there in her final resting place. So thank you all to your family for what you do for our community and what she meant to all of us.
Ready to vote? Alderman Baggett.
Yes.
Alderman Potts.
Yes.
Alderman Brown.
Yes.
Alderman Berger.
Yes.
Vice Mayor.
Yes.
Alderman Barnhill.
Yes.
Alderman Hansen.
Yes.
And Alderman Peterson.
Yes.
Passes unanimously. Thank you for being here tonight. And we're honored to be able to recognize her. Item number six, this is a public hearing, consideration of resolution 2022-19, a resolution initiating the annexation by referendum process and draft plan of services for the annexation of 25.12 acres located west of the Paytonsville Road and Dyke-Bennett Road intersection north of Paytonsville Road. Joey?
Thank you and good evening. The city has received an annexation request for a property located in the Goose Creek Basin, but it is located outside of the urban growth boundary. Map of the property is a part of your exhibits. Annexation for properties outside the UGB cannot occur until a referendum has been held where a majority of the property owners requesting annexation vote to have their properties annexed by the city of Franklin. This resolution authorizes the request to the Williamson County Election Commission to hold a referendum on November 8th of this year in conjunction with the local county elections. A full timeline of the annexation by referendum is included as an exhibit with your materials. There is a draft plan of services included as well that lays out how the city can serve the property. No major issues came up with that draft plan of services. There is currently a larger land use study for the Goose Creek Basin area, as well as a study to revise the urban growth boundary of the city of Franklin as well as the county overall. The applicant and property owner has requested to go ahead and move forward with the annexation, so would need a referendum. So staff recommends approval of resolution 2022-19. Thank you.
Thank you. I do have one speaker card. I have A.B. Yara. If you'll come forward, and I'll allow you 1 minute.
Good evening, everyone. Yeah, and thank you for giving me that 1 minute. Yeah, I've been living in Franklin since 2014, and this is a piece of property we purchased as family and friends, and we all want to live in Franklin, and we want it to be like be part of Franklin. So, yeah, we would like you to consider that for annexation. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Is there anyone I missed that wanted to speak to this item? Seeing none, I declare the public hearing closed and would entertain a motion.
Approved.
Thank you, Alderman Barnhill. Second by Alderman Hansen. Any discussion? Ready to vote. Alderman Baggett.
Yes.
Alderman Potts.
Yes.
Alderman Brown.
Yes.
Alderman Berger.
Yes.
Vice Mayor.
Yes.
Alderman Barnhill.
Yes.
Alderman Hansen.
Yes.
And Alderman Peterson.
Yes.
Passes unanimously. If the board does not mind, I'd like to go to item number 19 that we asked to be pulled from the consent agenda, which is consideration of a special event permit for Juneteenth celebration in downtown Franklin to be held on June the 18th, 2022. I would entertain a motion.
Move for approval. I'll second.
And go ahead. I see you want to speak.
I am for Juneteenth, and I'm so for Juneteenth, and I'm so thrilled that they're downtown, because I grew up in Texas where Juneteenth started, and I know the significance and the historic meaning behind Juneteenth and how incredibly important it is for us as a community to know, honor, and respect what it stands for. And because of that, I would like to see it expanded and have the city possibly set up a committee of vetted applicants for the committee from the Black community to work on this project together to bring them closer together, even more inclusive, so this can be a celebration that's something that they all love to celebrate and something that's shared with the rest of the community in the area so we can all understand more about Juneteenth, because it is a historic representation of In 1863, the Emancipation Proclamation freed the slaves, but in Texas, in 1865, they were still enslaved. And it wasn't until June 19th of 1865, 2 years later, that 2,000 U.S. troops arrived in Galveston to free the last of the slaves in the United States. And that's such a significant historic day, and we need to observe it as a community together, and I would love to see the community to come together with a committee that shapes a Juneteenth that their entire community will just be thrilled and delighted with, and I'm so glad to have you downtown.
Thank you. Other comments? Mm-hmm. Go ahead, Alderman Brown.
I'll acknowledge up front, I sit on the board of the African American Heritage Society, and I would echo, I just think it's such a fantastic annual event, and I think greater collaboration in the future would be great for the community as a whole, and would fully support the idea of doing so.
Any other comments from the board? Ready to vote. Alderman Baggett.
Yes.
Alderman Potts.
Yes.
Alderman Brown.
Yes.
Alderman Berger.
Yes.
Vice Mayor.
Yes.
Alderman Barnhill.
Yes.
Alderman Hansen.
Yes.
And Alderman Peterson.
Yes.
Passes unanimously. We'll now go to item number 6. This is a public hearing, consideration of resolution 2022-19, a resolution initiating the annexation by referendum process.
Sir.
I've already done that one.
Number seven.
Got me confused. This is a public hearing. We're looking at item number seven. Consideration ordinance 2021-05, an ordinance to rezone 233.66 acres from agricultural district and civic institutional district to plan PD 2.02 district for several properties located near the intersection of Hillsborough Road and MacHatcher Memorial Parkway, Brownland Farm PUD subdivision. Can we keep that door shut back there because of the echo of the sound? No, we'll try to not do it because it gets pretty annoying up here because I can't understand everybody says. Okay, go ahead, Amy.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. As Mr. Suki has mentioned in previous meetings, it is staff's role to provide information. You can't hear me? Let me get a little closer.
They can't.
All right.
Margaret 2.0.
There, I'm taller than that. All right, well, let me start again. As Mr. Suki has mentioned in previous meetings, it's staff's responsibility to provide information to the BOMA on the plans before them to help them make informed decisions on those plans. And so that's what I'm here to do. I've spoken a lot in previous meetings on this plan, so I'm going to try to summarize what I've said in the past about the plan and then also provide you some updates on some information that we've been given since the last time I've spoken. The first thing I'd like to point about this plan is that the general plan for the property, what it says in Envision Franklin. The map that you see here is the map of Envision Franklin, and the properties in red are the ones we're looking at today. The property is covered with two different design concepts. One is conservation, and one is conservation subdivision. The dark area in green is conservation. The light area is the conservation subdivision area. To talk a little bit about the conservation area, in Envision Franklin, it states that it contemplates as little development as possible in order to protect sensitive lands. A quote from Envision Franklin says, "The preservation of floodplains has a direct public safety purpose and helps to minimize property damage during periods of flooding." Now, conservation design concept is the only design concept that does not follow parcel lines, as you can see on the map. It follows the environmental features that are on the land. And so that's why there are two design concepts on a property when conservation is in place. Further, in the conservation design concept, it states in Envision Franklin, quoting, "It is intended that the majority of new development occur in the area where the second design concept applies." So looking at this map, Envision Franklin would support development in the light green areas, and it would support a little bit of encroachment into the green areas, because that's what majority means, that the majority is in the light green areas, but a little bit can eke in. So let's think about that in terms of the plan that you're reviewing today. Angie, if you could go to the next slide. So this is the proposal that's before you today. You can see that their proposed development area is shining through in the white area, I guess I could call it, where you see no colors. Their colors are the different lot types that they're proposing. And the area in red is where their proposed development is encroaching into conservation. So if you look at the area of red versus the area that's the plan that you can see unencumbered by conservation, I would ask you whether you think that the majority of the development is outside of conservation. Thinking about it a different way, if you were to think they could slightly encroach into the green area, then the red should be minimal. You should see a little bit of red light up, but perhaps not to this extent. Now, the applicant has brought up several projects that have been approved after Envision Franklin was adopted that have also creeped into the conservation area, lit up that area as red. And so I'd like to go over those for you
since they were brought up by the applicant. If you could go to the next slide. At previous meetings, the applicant has brought up Splendor Ridge, the fields at Reese Farms, Wood Duck Court PUD, Berry Farms Chatterell, their revision one. In looking at those plans, staff did an analysis of how much did those plans encroach into the conservation areas. So for Splendor Ridge, that was approved for 19 lots. Of those 19 lots, five of the lots were proposed in an area that was partially covered by floodplain, partially covered by that conservation design concept. None of the lots that they proposed were fully covered by existing floodplain or existing conservation, and none of the lots were either in partially floodplain area or floodway areas or fully encumbered by the floodway. So if you look at the five lots that encroached into the conservation against the 19 lots, that's about 26% of the overall development encroached into conservation. I think you can see that the majority of the development was outside of the conservation area. The next plan that was brought up by the applicant was Fields at Reese Farm. That plan had 132 lots approved by BOMA. Nine of those lots were partially in the floodplain, partially in that conservation area. Again, none of them were either fully in the floodplain as it existed on the property or in the floodway, either partially or fully. So, of the nine lots that were approved, of the 132, that equates to 7% of the overall development. Similarly, with the court PUD, it's a little bit different of a comparison because it was not single family lots. These were multifamily buildings. So you can see it was eight buildings with 237 units in total. Of those eight buildings, half of one of the buildings was in an area previously covered by floodplain, and that would have to be mitigated. And so of a half a building, in comparison to eight buildings, that's again about 7% of the overall development was in the conservation area. Berry Farms Chadwell was another one that the developer brought up as a comparison. This one is not an apples to apples comparison. Berry Farms Chadwell was originally approved in 2006. That was before Envision Franklin. Also, the floodplain maps were different at the time. You know, I think it was 12 years between the 2004 maps and the 2016 maps that we adopted from FEMA. And over that time, the maps changed. So they were showing development in what was now floodplain, but that was what was previously approved by this board. What they did not do is grow even further into the floodplain. They maintained their limits of what they had previously been approved for. So that one's a hard one to, you know, analyze against conservation because it changed over when they previously got things approved. Looking at the numbers that I just went through, we can also apply this analysis to Brownland Farms. Brownland Farms plan as submitted has 58 units. They're suggesting they want 356 units. I say units because they're not all single family lots. We have some multiplex lots, we have some duplex lots. So of the 356 units, 58 of the units are on lots that are partially within the floodplain today, partially within that conservation area. 147 of the units are on lots that are completely covered by floodplain today. 29 of the units are in areas that are partially covered by floodplain, and the rest of the land is partially covered with floodway. And then 18 units are on lots that are fully covered by floodway today. That adds up to 252 units. In comparison to the number that they're requesting, that's about 70.8% of their units. Again, I have that quote from Envision Franklin on there at the bottom of the screen. Envision Franklin says that for conservation, it is intended that the majority of new development occur in the areas where the second design concept applies. That majority should be in the conservation subdivision area, not conservation. Another point I want to bring up for BOMA to consider is the zoning ordinance and how it applies to the site. This policy of limiting development in the floodplain was taken from Envision Franklin and incorporated into the zoning ordinance in the floodplain overlays, the FFO and the FWO. Those overlays were adopted to align with our FEMA maps, so they directly relate to the floodplain, and they limit development in these areas. They don't prohibit all development. They do allow some uses to be there and some encroachments to be within the floodplain, but they do not permit residential development in either one of these overlays. Now, what's happened with this plan, it seems, is that we've jumped to the stormwater ordinance right of way. And the stormwater ordinance is set up so that when the uses that are permitted in the FFO and the FWO want to be constructed, the stormwater ordinance, as well as chapter 17.6 of the zoning ordinance, tell developers how to go about developing that to align with FEMA compliance and everything else. But the stormwater ordinance is not there so that carte blanche you can develop in the floodplain. It's the how for when the zoning ordinance tells you when. So we've gotten, I think, a little bit off track because we've jumped straight to the stormwater ordinance to see how they can meet those regulations. But we haven't taken a step back to look at the overlays on the property that exist that they're not rezoning out of, which do not permit residential development. Lastly, I would bring up that we've talked a little bit about emergency access on the property, and that the stormwater ordinance requires roadway and critical service roads to not be inundated by more than 3 inches of water over half of the roadway width during a 100-year flood event. In the proposal that's submitted to you today, there was an option where they would like to cross the Site 1 property to get that emergency access. The owner of Site 1 has contacted the city, and they have said they do not wish to engage with the developer for that option. That has been their last correspondence with the owner. So, within your plan, most likely will not happen. The developer has suggested an alternative route where they could raise up Fulton Greer and achieve that requirement of the stormwater ordinance. That hasn't been vetted by staff yet because it wasn't part of this package, so just know that while we have heard about it, we haven't thought through it or vetted it yet. So that could be something that works out at site plan, but it's not something that we can confirm could work today. So I'd now like to turn it over to Mr. Stuckey for some additional comments.
Thank you, Amy. I do want to speak as your city administrator about some what I think are some context around policy impact and policy implications as we think about this, and also where we are in terms of process. Obviously, this is a really important decision on a lot of levels. Yes, it's a specific development proposal, but it also has some pretty significant broader policy impact, and policy discussions, I think, are important. The property owner is well within their rights to pursue the sale and development of their land. That can and should be respected. But you as a board, as elected community leaders, have an important responsibility in determining if this proposed development indeed fits the community's needs now and in the future. In the judgment of the Planning Commission and of your professional staff, this development does not comply with the city's adopted land use plan in Vision Franklin. Instead of either making the proposed development comply or pursuing an amendment to the land use plan, the developer, well within their rights, chose to push the decision forward to the board on a specific proposal without adjusting policy or complying with policy. They also have not completed the conditional letter of map revision required by FEMA, Federal Emergency Management Agency, related to the floodplain considerations here. So that's a missing piece of the puzzle as well. The development before you and the developers have raised, I think, significant policy changes. In their mind, they don't think so. They've portrayed that based on two things. They say, well, your zoning ordinance kind of allows it, the stormwater kind of allows it. And I think Amy drove a pretty good point there in saying, because our ordinances tell you how you can do it, doesn't mean that you're approving it everywhere. It just gives you the kind of the framework, if you say it's okay, how to do it. It's like, you know, we may tell you how to build the pool, but we don't say it's okay to put it in your front yard or on your property line or out in the street. But we do tell you how to do it and what the right way to do it is. It's kind of maybe a silly analogy, but it's an analogy that gives you the point of, we give you guidance, but we don't say just because we give you guidance, it's allowed everywhere. The second point talks about that floodplain manipulation has been permitted before under Envision Franklin. The chart that's still on the screen that Amy brought up, I think, is really instructive. The applicant has really looked at it from a land area perspective. And that's okay, that's legitimate, and shown percentages. But I think where the real policy change and policy consideration lies is in those residential units. Look at that chart. We see that top line talks about where there has been partial mitigation or partial adjustment of the floodplain. 5 units in Splendor Ridge, 9 units at Reese Farm, a half of a building with wood duck. Those are all under Envision Franklin. Those are partial. The 3 areas below that talk about full mitigation in the floodplain, partial mitigation in the floodplain floodway, full mitigation in the floodplain floodway. Every one of those categories and all 3 of those developments are 0. When you look at what is in the proposed Brownland Farm development, you see, as the bottom line shows you there in yellow, almost 71%, 70.8% involve partial or full mitigation, floodplain mitigation to make residential units possible. In fact, 46% involve full mitigation, meaning the entire lot involves adjustment to your and manipulation of the floodplain. Regardless where you stand on this, I don't know how you can't look at these numbers and say that's a pretty significant policy change. And that's why I would say to you, I would think carefully about that. You don't want one development to change a policy and to become the policy. It ought to be thoughtful. It ought to look at the broader context. And that essentially you may be creating a policy change tonight, whether you know it or not. And we've still got 40 square miles of urban growth boundary to come. Does this become the new standard for that 40 square miles? Or existing land that wants to get developed or redeveloped within the city limits today. As I said, you never want to be in a place where you're making policy one development at a time. We need to do here what we did when we formed Envision Franklin to begin with, when it was created 5 years ago. Over an extended period of time, we engaged the community. We engaged property owners. We engaged the Planning Commission. We engaged our talented staff and outside subject matter experts. We work together to determine the best policy for the community. I'd like to draw a parallel to what we did 13 and a half years ago when I became your city administrator. We adopted some significant financial policies. And we did that intentionally away from the light or the context of any specific policy we wanted to fund or project we wanted to fund. We said, let's look at best practices. Let's look at AAA cities across the country. AAA cities that are facing growth pressures. Let's engage a well-respected, neutral third-party financial advisor to help us guide and direct those policies. And in the end, we have a series of policies we've been working from for over 13 years that has helped us weather the Great Recession, a global pandemic, all the while investing at an unprecedented rate in our infrastructure while keeping our debt load manageable. Less than 50% of that 10-year capital plan is funded by debt. So I know it's maybe not apples to apples, but it is an example of pulling it out, being thoughtful, engaging the community and experts and your staff team before you make a significant policy change. Because I believe that's what's facing you tonight in the context of what we see now and the development we're likely to see in the next year, 5 years, 10 years ahead. And I need to give you that context from my perspective. Thank you.
Okay. We are in the public hearing. And as you filled out your speaker cards for Brownland Farms, you were given a number. And so I'd like to ask the first 20 people to line up. Give your name. You have 1 minute to make your comments. So we'll start right there. Please, Courtney.
Hello. All right. Thank you. I'm Courtney Rogers. I'm a seventh generation Williamson Countyan. I'm a Navy veteran, small business owner, public school parent, resident of District 10, and I'm a candidate for Williamson County Commissioner. And I'm standing here before to ask you to vote no on the Brownland development. I remember the horrific flood of 2010. It wreaked havoc on our neighborhoods, specifically surrounding the Brownland Farms, Cottonwood, Fieldstone. I spent weekends helping friends recover from that. From the Williamson Herald, according to the Williamson County Emergency Management Team, the Comm Center handled 595 events that weekend. That was four times their normal load. The cost of damage was to about 1,400 residential structures, and it was almost $100 million. There was one death caused during this flood. In 20 years, we'll be the size of Nashville, and the answer to smart and strategic growth is not building in floodplains. This project is neither sustainable, nor does it provide infrastructure support like a new school for the kids that would occupy that land. I can tell you by looking at campaign contributions that some people up here have received money from the developer. Franklin is not up for sale. Thank you.
Let me just clarify, I'd prefer you not to be clapping after each person makes a point. It's important that we hear everybody. That's a distraction to the board. It's just like we don't allow signs in here, people jumping up and down. So if you'd respect that, I would appreciate it.
Angela Hubbard. I live in here in Franklin. We have done this for 2 years, many changes. The developer has now changed from 38 million gallons to 24 million gallons of water retention. That will fill in 7 minutes. 7 minutes. A flooding event usually lasts a couple of days. 2 days is 2,880 minutes. The added 7 minutes of storage only benefits the developer's numbers to alter shallow floodplains. The staff memo explained that to everyone, and I believe you need to listen to the staff and vote no.
Good evening. I'm Todd Kastner. I live at 3210 Del Rio Pike on a farm on the river. I'm a conservative, and I strongly believe in private property rights, and that foremost, we're a nation of laws, not a nation of men and women. We should follow our rules and regulations, including Envision Franklin, which is incorporated within our zoning code. We should also guard the taxpayer's purse. We should never attempt or suggest spending taxpayer monies on a development to benefit a developer or a landowner. Certainly, every property owner has the absolute right to sell their property. They are not, however, entitled to a zoning change, especially when the desired zoning change is in conflict with our regulations. There are countless examples of lethal disasters which were all engineered, including roadways, bridge failures, high-rise failures, aircraft disasters, flood disasters, lethal fires. Engineers are great, but they're not always right. They also have a bias as they're hired to get deals done. In this case, the cost of being wrong is disproportionately high because this development puts hundreds of families at grave risk and only benefits a very few. Hundreds of homes downstream that did not flood 20 and 30 years ago now do. Please follow your laws and regulations and vote no. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Deborah Smith, and I've resided at 411 Essex Park Circle in Fieldstone Farms for the past 26 years. I urge you to vote no to rezoning the proposed area and present the following for your consideration. I've heard several aldermen and other people mention that we should just trust the science and follow the experts because we're not engineers. We should look at what the proposal says and take it at face value. However, it is imperative that we keep in mind that the scientific conclusion is only as good as the modeling tools and data used. I learned that in college as a mathematician and a math major. I'm sharing with you one of the major shortcomings that I feel this Brownland proposal has to offer. Meteorological statistics show that rainstorms of 5 inches and higher have doubled in frequency in the greater Nashville and Franklin area since the flood of 2010. Severe storms are now more frequent and more intense, as evidenced by the March 2021 flood, 7+ inches, and the August 2021 Waverly, Tennessee catastrophic flood of over 17 inches of rain. Here's the problem with the expert reports. These increasingly larger rain events are not included in the projections. Floodplain and stormwater computer models used for developments are based on national rainfall statistics from 2004, over 18 years ago. And these tools also do not factor in the effect of when these storms occur back to back. So nothing in the developer's plan takes this documented increase in severe rainfall into account or its impact to surrounding neighborhoods. And we should be planning for another worst case scenario like we had in 2010. I sincerely urge you again to vote no to the rezoning. The public health and safety of the citizens you represent depend upon its defeat as proposed. Thank you for your time and attention.
Good evening, Board of Mayor and Aldermen, and thank you for this opportunity to address you tonight. My name is Elizabeth Wanzak, and I reside at 3130 Bush Drive. I speak before you today to kindly ask that you vote no on the rezoning and development plan for the Brownland Farms property. I have had the privilege to serve on the City of Franklin Housing Commission since 2017, acting as its chair from 2018 to 2020, and also had the opportunity to run as a candidate for the Board of Mayor and Aldermen for Ward 4. This past fall, during the most recent Ward Alderman election, opposition to this rezoning and development of the Brownland property was by far the issue that I discussed the most with residents and businesses of Franklin, and the majority are overwhelmingly against it. As a member of the Housing Commission, I have been aware of this proposal since the beginning and have had concerns from the start, as it is in a very active floodplain and even parts of the floodway. The proposal goes against Envision Franklin. It has been moved for disapproval by both city staff and the City of Franklin Planning Commission. The city engineer Paul Holzen explained in a BOMA meeting on September 14, 2021, that emergency vehicles would not be able to access residents of this new development in a flooding event, which risks the safety of not only our residents, but also our first responders. I implore you to support the decisions of the city staff and engineers, the Planning Commission, and our first responder personnel, and trust their unbiased expertise that this proposal is not right for Franklin and should not be approved. Thank you for your time.
Hi, my name is Penny Lukenhoff. I've lived in Williamson County for 18 years. Thank you for allowing me here to address you. I am just going to, for the sake of some perspective, read some statistics from the 2010, about the 2010 flood from the city website. 200 emergency calls to the City of Franklin Police during the 2010 flood. The average is 27. 30 to 35 streets were closed. This is a lot of manpower costs. Nearly 30 police officers on the roads at a time. Further manpower costs. A fire was at Fieldstone caused by the flood. Water in garage got into the gas tank of a parked car, which was ignited by a pilot light. Crews battled this fire in 4 feet of water in the dark. Franklin Fire Department was reduced. The Franklin Fire Department was reduced by close to 400 people. The Solid Waste Department collected, on average, 100 tons a day of debris over a 7-week period. City Parks sustained close to $500,000 in damages, with Fieldstone being one of two receiving the most damage. Thank you for having me here. Please vote no.
Hi, my name is Matt Ahern. I actually really don't have much prepared. I was sitting in the back and I noticed the wall of plaques and shields. I actually was a part of your adopted, I was with the first 327, 101st Airborne Division. And I just want to appeal to you as a son, as a father, as a husband, as a veteran. You people are here to protect the people that are already in Franklin. And I know that I represent hundreds, if not thousands, of families that could potentially be impacted by this development. If we are not 100% sure that this will not increase floodwaters, my ask is that you please, please vote no. And I also want to acknowledge Eric's statements on policy. I think it's incredibly important that we don't set a precedent, because if you do this now, how are we legally going to protect other homes from developers encroaching on policy change? So thank you for your time.
Good evening, Honorable Mayor and Aldermen. My name is Lillian Stewart. I live at 201 Lewisburg Avenue in downtown Franklin. In 1985, the state of Tennessee announced that General Motors Corporation would be building a large automobile manufacturing plant near Spring Hill. This action caused local government leaders in Franklin and Williamson County to convene and determine that a long-range plan should be adopted to guide the significant development that would occur into the foreseeable future. A nationally known firm was engaged to acquaint elected officials with a concept called comprehensive land use planning. That concept was based on the principle that development on one side of the community can significantly affect the value, cost, and the quality of life of existing development on another side. It is clear that the development in Franklin and Williamson County since that time has set us apart from countless other communities in our state and nation. Environmentally sensitive zoning is a key element in the protection of all property owners citywide. Since homeowners and citizens of Franklin will inevitably suffer as a result of overbuilding in this flood-prone area, I urge you to adhere to the consensus of your well-qualified planners and deny the development plan and the rezoning request before you tonight. Thank you.
Good evening. Michael Smith, 106 Poteet, Monticello. City Zoning Ordinance 20.7.8 lists specific approval criteria that BOMA shall use for recommendations and final action on a rezoning. These include, number one, whether the proposed rezoning is consistent with Envision Franklin and the purpose of the ordinance. Number two, whether the proposed rezoning will protect the health, safety, and welfare of the public. This rezoning request does not comply with Envision Franklin. It does not protect the health, safety, and welfare of the public, and the third criteria does not apply. All the other issues related to whether or not it will flood, emergency access, what use might be made of the land otherwise, etc., are moot and do not matter at this point, as rezoning this property without following Envision Franklin is illegal. Vote no.
My name is Pam Lewis, 4081 Columbia Pike. Thank you for the opportunity to speak, and thank you all for serving. I've been asked, because some of the people sitting here are a little bashful and they're not planning to speak, so I've been asked if anyone is opposed to this plan, please raise your hand.
I'm sorry. That's not appropriate.
Sorry, Ms. Mayor, Lewis. I didn't realize that, but I was asked to. I appreciate what Mr. Stuckey said, and I think he really encapsulated it in a nutshell. There have been numerous, I don't know who on the city is actually for this plan. We have so many city staffers that have voted, that have spoken out against it. I would just ask, why are we looking at a plan that necessitates an evacuation route? Makes no sense to me. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Laura Turner. I live at 1108 Dickinson Lane off of the old Natchez Trace. We gather again and are allowed a moment to speak against a mega-density development proposal surrounded by floodwaters. Twice, Franklin planners have recommended denial of the Brownland Farm rezoning and dangerous development plan. Citizens gathered lawfully last Wednesday and again on Sunday to create a public service announcement to warn people traveling on Hillsborough Road about this pending threat. We had a permit from the city for our lawful event, which was abruptly crashed by the developer and landowner. They tried to intimidate us by jerking up our signs and taunting us with intimidating comments while taking cell phone video. We persevered. If honking is any indication, the public is in support of our actions. Does the developer think that a tantrum he pitched on Sunday will garner your approval for this development debacle? He is a bully. I was incredulous when I read the conclusion part of the packet he submitted to you, which states, and I quote, "In all, we have taken feedback from neighboring communities, city staff, and BOMA members over the course of 3 years to create a plan that lives light on the land, provides a mix of for-sale housing types, and improves the safety and well-being of our neighboring communities in more ways than one. I submit he has ignored feedback and created a proposal that devastates and manipulates the floodplain, endangering the public safety and welfare to feed his greed and arrogant avarice. Please deny this rezoning and dangerous plan. Thank you."
Good evening, Board. My name is Jay Jose. I'm a Williamson County resident. I work here in Franklin, Tennessee. I am a builder and I am a developer and have worked to develop many projects here in Franklin, Tennessee. And many of these have been along the Harpeth River. all of these I have direct experience with, understanding exactly the detail and incredible discipline that goes into evaluating these projects, and can certainly appreciate that and to their magnitude and to what's before us. I'm a firm believer in these disciplined approaches and of analysis and engineering to meet the objectives and to do no harm. These communities, you know, serve a purpose, you know, that I've been involved with to develop and build. Many of the people that are in this room today are likely residents of some of these communities that I speak of. Whether private projects or public, all projects must be evaluated to the same exacting standards. For example, there are many public projects, such as the Southeast Park, which is an awesome project, a public project. The city engaged the services of a professional engineer, determined do no harm, while reducing the flood storage capacity. Brownland Farm increases the flood storage capacity. I would ask that you consider that based on the facts and approve the Brownland Farms project.
Mr. Gamble, I'm going to ask if you'd wait till the end, since you're the applicant.
Okay, I'm happy to.
If that's satisfactory with you.
Yes, it sure is.
Good evening. I'm Nell Henderson. I'm a resident of Monticello, 202 Revere Lane. I've lived on the Grassland area for almost 32 years. I've driven it many times. I'm not going to go and discuss the flooding issues that have already been so expertly covered by the experts and Envision Franklin, but when talking with my neighbors this week, the next issue in the reverberations that might happen when we build a increasing densely development across the street is the traffic that we have on Hillsborough Road. I want to remind you that we have four elementary schools, including the middle school. We have 995 students in Grassland Middle, 525 in Grassland Elementary, 427 in Hunter's Bend, 525 in Walnut Grove. Then you add, that's 2,472. Now, you know how many parents have extracurricular activities that drive their children to school, and that's the reason we have these many traffic problems that we have after 2:30 in the afternoon till almost 6 in the afternoon. Now, add on to that, you've still got 1,757 students enrolled in Franklin High School. Now, this elementary program that would be serving in the Franklin Special School would be also going up Hillsborough Road. Now, if you can't see this logical pattern of huge traffic that would be an alternative reverberation coming from this intensely development You have to understand that. And if you, I've lived there, I've worked in the schools, I've substituted in the schools. I had rental property at River Rest. We lived in River Rest and we've lived in Monticello. So we've experienced all the flooding problems and all the traffic issues along with all the other issues that have been discussed already. And you are the gatekeepers of our community. You have extreme power in what you let bomb into our community and what you keep out. And I will ask you to vote no on this particular development. There's some other developments that could be done on Brownland Farm that would be a great asset to our community, like recreation, or organic farming, or just several things. Thank you very much.
Good evening. I'm Dr. Ryan Jackwood. I live in Bellevue, and I'm the science director for the Harpeth Conservancy. I brought a map today that is publicly available on the Williamson County website. And it's a map basically comparing the floodplain that was established in 2016 report to the FEMA floodplain and the proposed floodplain in 2020. And I've got an orange and a red circle here that show an expanded area of the floodway along Brownland Farms on the main stem of the Harpeth. And in blue, I've got circled a green area where it's expanded area for the 2020 preliminary proposal for the 100-year flood event for that area as well. And I wanted to just make some general comments about flood maps as we kind of use them in practicality. One of the differences involved in these two maps is the more current map, obviously, is going to use more current data. So the 2020 map, we would assume uses the most current data, but actually the data was only up through 2012 that we're using. And so we're missing 10 years of potential events and data that we could collect for those regions. I would also like to put the Army Corps of Engineers is about to start an update of the flow data for Davidson County, which will include the Harpeth, and the work will be finished in about a year, which will be a valuable resource for projects like this. The more frequent rain events may even require a flood map to be updated about every 5 years, because obviously we want the most current data to feed into these decisions. And the last comment I'll make too is we look at these flood maps and we draw these very defined lines. Well, the probabilities. And so if you build your house 10 feet outside of this line, that doesn't mean it's not going to flood. Thank you.
Sir, if you wouldn't mind giving us a copy of that for our record.
Sent to the digital comments in the email comments.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Dory Bowles, Executive Director of the Harpeth Conservancy. And yes, that map was provided in our comments. I just wanted to reinforce the public safety issue, which is one of the criteria that has to be met for rezoning, either for rezoning and a development plan. And not to sound like a broken wheel, this is the most unusual place we have in Franklin. It's completely surrounded by floodwaters, and there are three floodway channels. One of the big safety issues is that with all of the work being done and analyzed over on this side to manipulate the floodplain, the project starts here and goes this way. So the flood waters on Hillsborough Road, 2.25 feet, and then down here, foot to foot and a half of Macatcher, do not change. Those are major public safety issues. There are other speakers here that have more experience and expertise than I do, but that is very important to keep up with. There's also, this floodway will be filled, and then some of the development plan has houses right at the edge of the floodway. As my colleague said, these are probabilities. These are not lines on a map and walls that don't change. And we can't exactly predict the future. And so with our flood, we were talking about rainfall earlier, and I'll wrap up. The flow data, and that's what I was talking about with the Army Corps last week. They update the stats on the flow in the river. So we're working off of 2012 number crunching for the flow. They're going to update everything in about a year. You really need that information. I think this area, especially for some of the things Alderman Baggett's interested in, we need to look at some flood probability work and figure out what we can do to actually maybe improve some of the situations. Thank you very much.
My name is Clint Long, and I live at 1040 Wellsworth Drive in Fieldstone Farms. My background includes 45 years of real estate, with 20 of that as a real estate appraiser. Plus, I majored in real estate at UT. Franklin, I won't repeat that the staff did that. I tell you, I'm really appalled. I went over all those videos, Spent a lot of time on it, then went in and studied FEMA. FEMA is an important factor, but FEMA is a reactor to things. They're not a preventer. I've repeatedly in 2010, there was people all over the place that did not live in a flood zone and they were flooded, like Carriage Hills. Then there was people in flood zones that wasn't flooded. I run into a lady when I was looking at Riser Point real good, and she had moved. She had been across the Harpeth River from River Landing. She was in a 500-year floodplain, and she had to be pulled out by a boat. The Waverly thing, the nurse that had to go to the top of her roof that was looking at another house, scared to death that her mother was dead, is a very good friend of my daughter who's a nurse at St. Thomas. The figure right here on Cotton Lane, 1/4 mile south of there, to about 200 yards across the river to Fieldstone Farms. That had a house that was the 500-year floodplain from the right, came underneath the house, and the 100-year floodplain come all the way up to the house. You can see it right there. The I pulled the deeds, I pulled everything else, and it cost $65,000 back then to be repaired. So I won't go over that much more. So when I hear somebody say that FEMA is the expert, FEMA reacts
to
stuff.
You're going to wind up, please.
Okay. They're overloaded. They're underfunded and politically manipulated, and that's the way people try to put the narrative on them. Thank you for the time. I vote no.
My name is Devin Phillips. I live at 2056 Belmont Circle, Franklin, Tennessee. So my big concern is really how many concessions do we have to make for this development to go through? 350 homes, and we want to spend $8 million to raise Hillsborough. We want to take a landowner's right away so that we can build an access for emergency vehicles over site, well, site one, always the flower power, is what I always called it. Or we want them to be able to go raise the road, go down to the rec center, and cut across to Mac Hatcher. What are we gonna, like, where's the end? What do we have to give to 350 homes that affects tens of thousands of people? If you go down Hillsborough to Mac Hatcher right now, think about, it was just finished. It was just finished being paved. Now they wanna rip it all up, raise it up a little bit. It doesn't make the businesses any higher. It just makes the road a little higher, so emergency vehicles can go across it. But you're not really worried about everybody who lives here. You're not worried about how many people will be affected by 350 homes that are potential homes for people that probably don't live here right now, because most people in Franklin don't move across town or next door. They stay in their home for a long, long time. Like, well, growing up, I still don't know anybody that's left. They retired. That's about it. And then they go to Florida. So, thank you for your time. Thank you for your service.
I haven't used bifocals in 15 years, so I'm not going to use them. I'm John Henderson. I reside at 202 Revere Lane here in Franklin. I'm a lifelong resident of Williamson County. Most of that was in the city of Franklin. In my youth, I was twice a member of the Franklin Planning Commission. I was never a member of the Board of Mayor and Aldermen, though I even considered at one time running for Alderman. But like members of the Board of Mayor and Aldermen, and like my father before me, I have been an elected official in Franklin and Williamson County. I know and understand what is owed the public by office holders. If I were a member of the Board of Mayor and Aldermen, loving Franklin as much as you and I both do, and regardless of whether I represented a ward or served at large, I would never forget that my obligation was always to the entire community, not to a select few. To make the city better, and under no circumstance ever to make it worse. This project does not improve the city in any way. It does hurt Franklin in a multitude of ways. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Laura Smith and I live at 106 Poteet Place in the Monticello subdivision. The city adopted a new zoning ordinance in December 2019. This new ordinance states that its purpose and intent is to promote the public health, safety, and general welfare of residents and businesses in the city. It states that its adoption is to achieve a number of items, the very first of which is to implement the policies and principles contained in Envision Franklin. The rezoning section of the ordinance lists approval criteria upon which BOMA shall base approval of rezoning. The first of these criteria is whether or not the proposed rezoning is consistent with Envision Franklin. This rezoning is not consistent with Envision Franklin and therefore is not allowed under Franklin's zoning ordinance. Follow the law and deny the request to rezone. Thank you.
Hannah, I think we're ready for the next 20.
We just call 20 to 40 to stand up.
Please. Yeah. No.
Sticker, I think so.
I don't know. Is that what that is?
That's employee of the quarter material right there. Seriously.
I'm sipping to make sure. I'm just sipping.
Okay, go ahead, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you for the opportunity. I'm Cindy Witt. I've lived in Franklin for 15 years. I'm asking you to vote no on this proposal for a number of reasons. You've heard about the flooding. You've heard about the mitigation that needs to be done to Hillsborough Road. You've heard about increasing rains. We've heard stories that trust the engineers get it right. Well, the Corps of Engineers certainly didn't get the Nashville flood right. We lived through that. If the engineers had gotten it right, Franklin Road wouldn't be underwater. We wouldn't have subdivisions flooding now. FEMA, TEMA, Williamson County, Envision Franklin, the Planning Commission, and staff all advise against building in floodplains and floodways. This proposal is 70% in floodplains and floodways. That is just an enormous encroachment into that area. Stormwater runoff increases 36 times on impervious surfaces over open land. Think about that, 36 times more floodwater running off from this development than we currently have now. Who benefits? Landowners and developers only. There's no benefit to the city of Franklin. Who pays? Taxpayers pay. Infrastructure and maintenance for stormwater, water, sewers, roads, schools, public safety, emergency response, and lawsuits. Homeowners pay for flood damage to their property, injuries, potential loss of life, flood insurance, and property value loss. You have a moral and legal imperative to vote no on this irresponsible and unsustainable rezoning development. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Judy Alexander. I have lived in Franklin for 22 years. I moved here from Nashville to get away from all the traffic and congestion. Here it is. I'm going to ask you to vote no, and I'm going to do a little different path. A lot of what I wanted to talk about has been covered, but I want you to think about the tax liability and the liability to the city of Franklin, how much money it's going to cost when it floods. And it will flood. It's in a floodplain. We don't know how often it will flood, but it will. You heard how much the 2010 flood cost. Well, this is just going to add to it. According to FEMA, 1 inch of flood water can cost $25,000 of damage to an average residence. That's just 1 inch of water. FEMA has also increased insurance rates, and they can raise them as much as 18% a year. That could soon make those houses unaffordable to the people that live there if we have flooding very often. Also, FEMA has run out of money. They don't take in enough from premiums, so they borrow from the government. That is also our tax dollars that we're paying. So it's not only what we pay into the state, it's what we pay into the federal government. Thank you.
Steve Kuhn, 311 Monticello Road, Franklin. Who do we want to be as a city? Do we want to be a family-friendly place where those who work here can afford to live? An attractive place to do business, maybe? Welcoming to future investments and tax base? If so, how does that happen? Predictability and trust. Trust that we will follow our ordinances and that proposals will receive a fair review. Respecting developers just as we expect them to respect our ordinances. It must work both ways. We must act with integrity and reward compliance with ordinances. At the same time, working through proper channels to improve any ordinances as necessary to clarify expectations for future developments. Staff, planning, and BOMA must be aligned without competing agendas. We must not punish developers who do all that is asked of them and often much more. We must decide to be accommodating rather than antagonistic towards new proposals. Let's stop moving the goalposts during the game. Nobody wants to sign up for that in the future. Those developers who Franklin will need in the future to help us grow are watching. We are better than this, and our residents and those who do business with us deserve better. I urge approval of this proposal that complies with all city ordinances. Let's let FEMA do their job now. Thank you.
Good evening, Taylor Morris. I live at 400 Stable Drive in Cottonwood. I wasn't born here, but I got here as quick as I could. 1991, raised my family here and love this town, love you people. Many of you all, I know personally, you're my neighbors. I'm called to love all of you, whether we agree or not. I've seen what the Harpeth can do. I've seen it at flood stage. I know it deserves all of our respect. I know that a lot of our neighbors either oppose the proposal or don't believe the engineer's report, but I take the position that in situations like this, who can you go to but engineers and experts, civil engineers, hydrologists, weather trend experts, when deciding what's best for the community? And all the experts, whether they're the developers' engineers or the city's engineers or the independent engineers, are all saying the same thing, that there's no measurable impact as a result of this this development. At least they it's possible they're even making it slightly better in some areas. But one thing they have said categorically to me is that no structure would be impacted by this development. If it did, I couldn't support it. Some believe that just leaving the river alone is the best policy. That's the best form of conservation. It seems to me that improving the existing condition, as this development does, is good stewardship and good policy. The development meets or exceeds Franklin's requirements, so I urge approval. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Ivy Huseman. I reside at 809 Highgrove Circle. Sorry, I'm short. My name is Ivy Huseman. I reside at 809 Highgrove Circle in River Landing, part of Franklin, Tennessee. I am a 22-year-old recently professional eventer, show jumper, dressage rider, trainer, and coach. Bellman Farms has been a second home to many equestrians over the years, both local and from all over the United States. It has taught the USA equestrian community many lessons, not just in the show ring or regarding horses in general, but it has given us hope of future jobs and friendships some people could have never dreamed of. It has given the city of Franklin and people all over the country a purpose in life. Though I don't want to sit up here and bash the Anderton family, obviously I'm so thankful for you guys, and the Anderton family has done so much for this community, and I'm forever thankful for you guys for selling their property by all means. That's the beauty of being in America, having your rights. However, I do want to urge those who want to develop Bellman Farms, take away the barns, the incredible arenas, and the land that was built on love for one another, families, both blood and those developed through experience, the blood, sweat, and the tears that lay upon Bellman Farms land for decades. It has been an equestrian facility, so why take it all away? To bring in more traffic, our roads can't handle, put more individuals, animals, and nature itself into harm's due to the flooding of the Harpeth, what else is there to gain but more money? I can only speak for myself, but the city of Franklin wants places like Harlansdale, Percy Winter Park, the list goes on, where we can enjoy the beauty of God's creation and nature in general without having to worry about our city going underwater any worse than it already has been. From horse shows to clinics, trail rides, to maybe even cross-country schooling, or even just a nature park where people could host other sports games, practices, and other after-school and extracurricular events, there's a plethora of options for Bellman Farms to be changed into. But more homes is just not something that is a necessity, nor very beneficial to anyone in general. I urge you to rethink your choice of developing Bellman Farms. At the end of the day, shouldn't your decision be based on what the people who already live here and have lived here for you years would like to see done in their city? Thank you so much.
Before you start, Commissioner, I wanted to recognize Commissioner Sturgeon that's here with us tonight. There were several other commissioners here from the county, so I'm sorry I didn't recognize many of you earlier. There was a lot of people in here, so please go ahead, Commissioner.
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you for allowing me to speak to you tonight. I am Barb Sturgeon, and I'm a commissioner for District 8 in Williamson County. And I have a District 8 is not, Bellman Farms is not in District 8, but it's right next to District 8. And I'm here to speak up for those people who aren't in the city of Franklin, but who will be affected by this floodplain if it's overwhelmed. And I've been going door to door lately because I am in campaign mode. And that would be the number one overwhelming issue for District 8 is there's so many neighbors who have been devastated by storm water control that's not working. Let's just put it that way. You can call it flooding. But 30 years ago, they weren't having problems. But now their storm water control system is not capable of handling the new demands, whether it's new developments that have created more impervious land, or whether it's meteorological heavier rains than we've ever had before. But it is devastating. And I'm afraid that this is going to benefit a small number of people and have a devastating effect to the neighbors around it. And I do agree that we have been elected with the trust of the people, and we need to do everything we can to protect them, the whole community. And we need to start looking at not just the engineering, or, you know, I happen to be an engineer, and I understand that engineers aren't God. And when you do a calculation, you have to make assumptions. And if you make poor assumptions or inadequate assumptions, you come up with poor and inadequate results on your engineering calculations. So it's not good enough to just say the engineers are saying it's okay. When, I mean, I've had engineers say, Sneed Road, the traffic on Sneed Road is fine and we're going to keep it that way. And my own eyes are telling me, no, it's not okay on Sneed Road. So you can't give me a traffic study saying that it's okay and that we're going to keep it okay. There's something wrong with your assumptions. So I don't mean to go on and on and on, but basically what I'm trying to say is you're going to impact the people outside of this area. And we have an obligation to those people. So I would ask you to vote no on this particular development and do whatever we can to start looking at the bigger picture of the whole watershed, not just one development at a time. So
thank you.
And thank you for everything you guys are doing. I know you're serving us, and that's not always easy. Thank you,
Commissioner. I do see Commissioner Williams and Guffey back there in the back, and I think I saw Commissioner Morton, too. So glad you're here.
Mr. Mayor, Alderman, my name is John Walsh. I live at 111 Bay Hill Circle, Franklin. I am a co-director of the program in disaster research and training at Vanderbilt University Medical Center. One of the issues that I want to talk about very briefly is the emergency access. This needs to be permanent. It needs to be two-lane hard service. A non-permanent pathway with a crash gate is not adequate for emergency vehicles under these conditions. And with the potential evacuation of hundreds of vehicles, water-soaked surfaces are subject to heavy rainfall, can deteriorate very quickly, as we all know. The costs related to disaster response are permanent, they're continuous, and they're recurring. The burden of those costs remain the responsibility of the taxpayers, not only for the citizens of Franklin, but the citizens of Williamson County and even the state of Tennessee. Disaster costs are exacerbated by bad decisions and are incurred for years and decades in the future. There is a public safety concern relative to this proposal, and I urge you to take those concerns very seriously. I thank you for your time and your effort that you serve this community to making Franklin and Williamson County a great place to live. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Kathy Weber, 1900 Springcroft Drive. For 2 years, we, the citizens in the Franklin community, have strongly voiced our disapproval over the rezoning and development plan. That there is something better for this constrained piece of property that could benefit the city and the community, as heard by others. The rezoning of the property must meet the procedural guidelines stated in your zoning ordinances, and this plan does not. In my opinion and others, the applicant has violated the trust of the citizens, the Andertons, Christ Community Church, and this respected city due to all the misrepresentations of facts and the omissions of others. From stating that the flood water depths on Hillsborough Road were not greater than allowed, unethically involving Christ Community Church in a fundraiser for alderman candidates running in the last election, to misleading BOMA and the public. The letter to each of you in your packet from the legal counsel of the Glenn family, the Site 1 property owners, is the telling story. The developer and his representatives still continue to say in their material that you're looking at tonight that they are in discussion with the landowners. This legal letter says differently. So as recommended by your planning staff and planning commission, we trust that you will vote no and deny this rezoning tonight. The public welfare requires it.
Good evening, everybody. Excuse me. My name is Dan Salisbury, and I've lived in Williamson County for the past 4 years. I moved here when I retired from the Army, where I served as a Special Forces Officer or Green Beret for the better part of 20 years. I mention this only because I do have a good bit of knowledge when it comes to planning and planning for contingencies. When planning, we plan against the most likely threats and have contingency plans for the most dangerous threats. When assessing those threats, we listen to our intelligence experts who specialize in this kind of work, who have studied the enemy, the tactics, their composition, etc., using the enemy's past activity and our current technology to the best of their ability to produce their expert advice. We ignore what these experts say at our own peril, literally at our own peril. Back to here. From the two previous hearings that I watched online, it sounds like the development team brought forth a plan designed to city standards. They briefed that plan. They were asked to address some issues to ensure that their plan would withstand the most dangerous threat of flooding. then returned with all those issues addressed and answered. Where they had to, they hired experts to address how their plan stood against the flooding issues, as did the city. Two different sets of experts were hired. Locally based hydrologists, experts in their field. I'm not a hydrologist, and I'm pretty sure that nobody out there protesting about flooding is either. The experts with years of experience in today's technology to aid their work are the ones we need to listen to here. And these experts said that this project not only does not create flooding issues, but that it helps reduce flooding issues in that area. This is what the experts say. And they are the ones that we should be listening to. Please consider this when you vote to approve this project this evening. Thank you.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Tim Hott. I run the horse shows and help the Andertons at Brownland Park. I've been here since 1989, and pretty well we've almost outgrown that place. We're full all the time. The biggest comment I hear is, if we didn't live where we live now, we would live in Franklin. So I don't think the traffic is going to get any better out of here. Unfortunately, you live in a city that everybody wants to live in. And we've truly planned on moving somewhere else and starting this horse show. The horse shows will not be going anywhere other than Franklin, Tennessee. I deal with people's safety all day, every day. And I sort through facts from fiction to hidden agendas to personal opinions. And you guys have a lot of sorting to do up here because you're hearing it all. But as far as I can see, you're not getting any smaller. Houses are needed. And if we don't listen to engineers, who do we listen to? Is there other people smarter than that? I just think keep the facts and the fictions separated, guys. And thank you very much.
Well, I'm sure y'all know where I live. 1155 Hillsborough Road. My name's Robin Anderton, and I want you to not fall for all of the rhetoric and all the false information from a local conservancy group here in our town, and listen to the facts of it. And please vote yes for this project. Obviously, I'd be for it.
Hi, Michelle Anderton again. I wanted to talk about something, a little bit about what Tim said, but I want to speak to the equestrian community, and in particular, some mistruths or lack of information. Brownland Farm is our business. 1155 Hillsborough Road is a part of the 233.66 acres in this project. And because Brownland Farm is the most well-known piece of the property, it has become Brownland Farm. The horse community by far know that our goal is to pick up and go somewhere. We can actually grow and make it a better, bigger horse show on a smaller footprint without paying what it costs to maintain almost 200 acres. The horse community, the outlying horse community, like I guess Ivy, who spoke a minute ago, have no idea that our plan is not to go away. Brownland Farm is not for sale. Brownland Farm horse shows are not for sale. And I wanted to let people know that. And then another mystery, if the land was developable, it would have been done years ago. My mother-in-law and late father-in-law, who passed 11 years ago tomorrow, that was never their dream. Brownland Farm was their dream. They had people ask them if they would sell. That wasn't what they wanted. But our family has evolved. There's five of the next generation coming up. We've already talked about this. It's time to make that change for our business. And I hope that you don't ignore the science. I know there's so many people in here that are afraid. They have a form, you know, I call it PTSD. We flooded, we know. But I hope you base your decision on the science. That's all I ask you to think about. Thank you.
David Zarnecki, 1002 Glastonbury Drive. And one of those people that was flooded in 2010 is me and my family. I would vote no if, for no other reason, the experts in FEMA said in 1998, when I moved into my house, not in the floodplain, not close. In 2004, it was at my back property line, and in 2010, well, it was in the road. Thank you. Vote no.
Hi, I'm Mary McAfee, Mary Hatcher McAfee. My children are fourth generation Williamson County residents. My family dates back for many years. And I was first going to speak to you about the parking situation that I had mentioned about the park. And I live at 107 Poteet Place, which is in Monticello. But something crossed my mind when they were talking about separating the rhetoric from all the mishmash. Well, here's some proof in the pudding about what Franklin has already had to do. As Monticello was annexed into the city of Franklin, the creek behind my house, which is what saved my house from being flooded in 2010, filled to the gills, came up to my backyard. But after that point, because of the development, all the water, and since we were annexed into the city of Franklin, it became a causeway, and city of Franklin is responsible for it. And thanks to Mr. Stuckey and his team, the engineers, they came in and discovered, and I showed him that my children, my animals, my family, that my livelihood was in danger because the causeway, which leads directly into the Harpeth, and the volume of water that is now coming through there currently today was eroding. I had Hawaii 5-0, my trampoline, and then here's the section of the creek, the causeway that had carved out just from the water flow that came through. And the city came in, engineers inspected, and you all put in heavy boulders and riprap pieces into that just small portion of the creek. And so if you're talking about adjusting all these areas, you've got to think about how much expense is the city going to put in to protect those, because my home and those boulders are shifting now. I have great concerns about the future of all these causeways. And is the city going to pay to come in and riprap and protect all of these areas behind our homes that are washing away due to the current circumstances? And the last thing that I have to say is I don't know what the deal is with the parking around the situation in the proposed area in Monticello. I mentioned this and my concerns in the last BOMA meeting, and our HOA representative, Dave Lawball, came up to me and told me that the developer assured that they would put up no parking signs around the park area, and that they would have a parking lot set up across the street in Brownland Farms, and plan to put a tunnel underneath Hillsborough Road for people to access the park and walk underneath Hillsborough Road. Now, I don't know if this is true or if it's even a part of the plans or what's in the proposal, but that's what I was told, and I was, you know, he said that they assured that. So I just needed to mention those things, but please vote no for the protection of our city and the future of our children. Thank you very much for your time.
Honorable Board, my name is Socrates Panagis. I work at Land Solutions Company for the applicant at 2925 Burial Drive in Nashville. I've worked very closely on this job for over 3 years, and I'd like to say that Kevin and Greg have done a tremendous job of being flexible and working with the community to satisfy each and every concern that's come up along the way. In the early stages of this project, before it was ever brought to Planning Commission or BOMA, the biggest community concern was centered around a potential commercial development in front of Monticello, as well as concerns by Christ community about how a development would coexist with the church. The development team alleviated these concerns in such a positive way that it seemed many, not all, but many members of Christ community in Monticello were actually excited for what was to come. At other points in time since, the land plan amendment, traffic, density, floodplain disturbance, and condo buildings were all hot button issues. And when it seemed that the development team finally mitigated all these issues through plan changes and expert reports, the public safety issue of flooding and Mackatcher and Hillsborough Road was brought to light hours before second reading. Now that the development team has worked with the city to come up with a viable solution to this problem, all at the developer's expense, I believe it is time for this project to move forward. Kevin, Greg, and others with the development team have held dozens of meetings with the city, community, neighbors, and have acted with integrity throughout. They've kept their cool in the face of insults and harassment, and I believe they're the right people to finish out this zoning. Thank you.
I also see Commissioner Ramey back there. Thanks for being here.
Hello, my name is Matt Huff with Gamble Design Collaborative, the planner on the development, 3020 Stansbury Lane. I grew up in Franklin, and after 3 years of searching, we finally are about to become Franklin residents once again. So we're ecstatic about that. I would like to speak quickly on, specifically on the rezoning, which will be the first thing that you all vote on tonight. The zoning ordinance identifies three things to consider when rezoning a property. First, is the proposed rezoning consistent with envisioned Franklin and the purpose of the ordinance? Yes, the planned development district allows for a mix of housing types that are supported in conservation subdivision. Second, will the rezoning protect the health, safety, and public welfare of the public? Yes, the development will be built to all of City of Franklin standards, and all floodplain alteration will be verified by FEMA. And third, will the rezoning meet the challenge of change conditions or changes necessary to advance the health, safety, and welfare of the city? Yes, the proposed rezoning allows for the adoption of a development plan that provides needed improvements and protection to the ecosystem of the Harpeth River, improves the floodplain capacity by 24 million gallons, and provides badly needed housing for Franklin, which as of today has only 137 homes for sale in a city of 90,000 people. Thank you.
Good evening, Amy Wells, 303 Gillette Drive, Franklin River Landing Subdivision. With another flood, parents will be trying to get home to their kids, others trying to get home to their pets or elder parents, all coming down McHatcher, while others are trying to cross it to find higher ground before they're flooded in with this evacuation route they're proposing. All of this in the dark, in heavy rainstorms, black, wet, unsafe roads with blinding reflection from the lights. This is a nightmare. Police and vehicles will be required for ordering this mess, but they may be needed elsewhere for car accidents or health crises. Therefore, it is a county issue as well. Anyone who says this won't happen hasn't lived through it like me. They are being prideful, unrealistic, and should not be heeded. With public safety, all possibilities should be considered. All. During the 2010 flood behind our home in River Landing, the Harpeth looked and sounded like the Mississippi River. We kept watching and wondering, how far is it coming? We moved our elderly neighbors' precious items from their flooding garage to their first floor as they were out of town, thank goodness. We assessed our situation. We decided to flee to friends who lived on a hill in Fieldstone Farms, Simmons Lane, at the back of the subdivision on the corner of Fieldstone Parkway and Cotton Lane. Driving down Gillette Drive in 3 to 4 feet of water, cars were flooding out all around us. My husband tried to help get some moving, but to no avail. We were able to leave as we just bought a Jeep that very week. So our family of five, ages 7, 11, and 13, escaped to higher ground. Heading south on Cotton Lane to Fieldstone Farms, we see the waters are deeper and moving up ahead, and we cannot enter on Fieldstone Parkway. There's an emergency white gate facing Cotton Lane and Riverwood Drive. It is at the end of Harvington Drive in this rear section of Fieldstone Farms by Linwood Park. Other cars had pulled over wanting to enter. One vehicle was parents trying to get home to their kids. A resident of this section stood on the other side of the gate in the storm and said, "We could not move the gate," and he'd call the police. This is the craziness that happens in times of emergencies, and people don't think straight. He was clueless to what was happening, and if his family member had a heart attack or needed help, he would be trapped too. Several moved the gate, and we entered and found safety with our friends. Please follow your laws. Thank you.
Okay, I've got, thank you for your comments. I've got three low numbers that have not come forward, and that's Kathy Bavona, Joe Clayhorn, and David Lawball. So if they're not coming forward, I'm gonna discard their cards. So we'll go for the next 20.
I'm Don. I'm Don Davis. I reside at.
Excuse me, just a second.
Oh, I'm sorry.
And I'd intended for the applicant to speak last, which is generally our policy. So, if there are any other people speaking on behalf of the applicant, I'll hold you to the last with Greg Gamble, Mr. Gamble. So, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No problem. I'm Don Davis. I live, excuse me, at 1035 Neil Crest Circle. I've been a Williamson County resident for 13 years. I've also worked in the city of Franklin for 13 years. My wife and I dearly love this city, and in 3 months I'll be retiring here. So I'm happy to report that. Full disclosure, I am on staff at Christ Community Church. I want to go on the record as to say how much I know that the church loves this community as well. I wanted to state real briefly three considerations that were taken in this process. Number one, embrace the inevitable. Franklin is growing. We know that. It's coming. Let's do it healthy and carefully. Number two, maximize the opportunity. Since the church had an opportunity to join forces with a developer and a landowner and speak into the project and collaborate, we said, let's move ahead. Let's welcome low-density growth that incorporates green space, trails, parks, just quality aesthetics. And then thirdly, trust the experts. Seems the biggest concern is flooding. I'm certainly no expert. I don't know that many are in this room, just a few. And so I think it makes sense to trust the experts. I believe we still have FEMA after all this as well, who will be the final decision maker. And then finally, just a closing reminder that our church membership did vote on the project, and they voted 2-1 in favor of the project. So I speak in favor and ask that we honor the landowner's request, 3-year effort to sell his property, and the developer's multiple and numerous acquisitions and concessions. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Bob Ravener. I reside at 221 3rd Avenue South. I'm also the incoming president of the Downtown Neighborhood Association and sit on the board of the Friends of Franklin Parks. And as of today, formerly a candidate for District 61 of the State House, which, by the way, also is part of this district and what this all means to the folks among the counties of cities of Franklin and Brentwood. So I first want to thank all of you. I know many of you. Thank you for your commitment, dedication. I know you strive to do your best in these jobs, and they are not easy to do, so I applaud you for that. And we also know that people are flocking to our city and the county because of the quality of life that's been created by many of you and many of the people in this room. And I want to be clear that I'm for growth. I just want to do it in a smart way. I want people to be able to sell their properties, but I want them to be able to do it that's commensurate with their use. I also spent 3 days last week with many of you on a visioning trip to Georgia with 45 other community leaders, developers, and others in this room. And what an amazing trip that was to open up many eyes. And the one thing we learned from that was to look out 100 years, not make decisions one development at a time. There are so many unimaginable possibilities. This does not have imagination. We should not be building in a floodplain. The people are speaking out against it, and this is just wrong for Franklin. We're going to see development, want to see development. This is just not the right one. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Angela Calhoun. I live at 1035 Winfield Village Court. And I think that the information that has already been presented here tonight by Mr. Stuckey and the city staff and many citizens just really lays out a compelling argument that this is not in compliance with Envision Franklin. I just would urge you to vote no. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Steve Oleski. I'm 208 Forest Ridge Court. I'm going to give a little different idea. We shouldn't be building in a floodplain. The consensus is against it. Instead of taking money to accommodate this, why don't we take the money and buy it for a park and not develop it? And then everybody can benefit from it. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Walter Green. I live at 227 4th Avenue South, so I'm not a Brownland neighbor. I like the discussion of putting this land to good future use, but I'm concerned about the excessive disturbance of the floodplain, the layout and density of the housing, and firming up an efficient, proper emergency access. Safety should be priority number one. I'll leave the flood mapping issues to others, but I will say this is about a lot more than engineers. This is bigger than that. Precedent is a big deal here as well. We've just dodged a bullet on rezoning of Franklin Grove, and we know how important it is not to set a bad precedent. That can happen here if we stray too far from what is allowed by the zoning ordinance and envision Franklin. I think city policy is clear enough to have already killed this project. If there are issues with policy that need to be addressed, seems to me it makes sense not to pass this divisive proposal, but rather to resolve those issues so that the community and the city can get behind a revised or a brand new plan. Franklin deserves better than what is being proposed. I ask that you deny it. Thank you and appreciate your service.
Hi, I'm Grace Clausing. I live at 227 Meadow Green Drive. And I was flooded in March 2021, just a year ago. And I am obviously against the proposal. This is my daughter, Lucy Drew Clausing, and she's also against it. Are you against it? Yes. You've heard the experts, you've heard the science, all that stuff. I'm asking you to consider on a humanitarian level. My home, my neighbor's homes, they have been flooded, they have been destroyed. I'm asking you to think about the people that this is affecting, not the farm that the developer that will be getting a lot of money from this. I'm just asking you to please consider the current residents here and to not think about people moving in and that aren't here yet. They're not a part of Franklin yet. And so please think of my daughter, my other two children out there, and vote no, please. Thank you.
Thank you, board, for hearing us out tonight. I appreciate your service to our community. My name is Owen Jones. I live at 105 Monticello Road. To give you a little bit of perspective, my home sits immediately at the bend in Monticello Road as you come off of Hillsborough Road. I look straight across the field that we call Monticello Section 1 or the Etherly property, and I can see across to the property that's proposed to be being developed here. So what I would say is that one of the main things that happened when I moved to my home in 2014 is I came to understand the anxiety around the development of that particular plot of property on the east side of Hillsborough Road and how it was constantly it was up for sale the entire time that I've been there, proposed to be some sort of commercial development or another. And so this proposal, one of the reasons I support it is that this developer has worked really hard to put onto that property residents that are in keeping with the rest of our community. In addition to that, it takes that whole section and makes it a park and takes it out of play for some sort of future development. And I'm talking about it specifically the property on the east side of Hillsborough Road. I understand the concerns about egress in case of extreme flooding and things like that. It looks to me like from the plan that that's been addressed, and I think that this can be safely developed and people's safety can be guarded. And I just encourage you to approve the plan.
I'm short too. My name is Mary Pierce, and I live at 103 Woodview Court, and I appreciate the opportunity to speak to you. I have worked in trying to manage change over time and save what we all treasure about Franklin. I have canoed to Sonic with Rudy Jordan's husband in a flood and gotten coffee, actually served coffee. I was here when Fieldstone Farm was developed, and I can assure you that the engineers, the developers, everyone thought none of those houses would flood. But guess what? They did. I took food during 2010. So they did flood. There was a stream at Cool Springs Mall. There was a huge debate. The room was filled over, I think Clyde might remember that, and Ann, over what would be done to manage the stream. It was decided to direct it in front of the mall, and it would be beautiful, and the water would keep flowing, and it's full of trash bags and plastic bottles now. So in this time of looming climate change, I urge you to do what the City Envision Franklin Plan says, and that is to err on the side of caution and conservation on this land. Thank you. Vote no.
Good evening. I'm Jack Welch. I'm a resident of Franklin and attorney here locally, and I represent the Glenn family, the owners of the Flower Power property, upon which Site 1 currently sits, directly across the river from the proposed development. First of all, let us say on their behalf, we are not at all opposed to the Andertons selling their property, developing their property. It is their God-given right to do so, and we support that right. What the Glenn family does not support is the development proposed in its current iteration. We do not think it meets Envision Franklin. We do not think it meets the general plan. It is bad for the city. Specifically, it is bad for the Site 1 property. We also want to clear up one apparently misconception. It's been alluded to or stated that the Glens have been talking with the developer and negotiating with the developer about putting an emergency access across the Site 1 property, and that is absolutely not true. They were approached. They have considered a couple things early on, but they're adamantly against having that go across their property. I'm apparently out of time, so finally, I would like to say there's been some talk about following the science, doing what the science says, and all the talk about experts. I would respectfully remind this board that it has its own in-house experts in planning and staff. And we would recommend and respectfully urge you to follow staff's recommendations and the code as it exists today. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Mary Ann Collins, and I'm a Williamson County resident. I also work with the developer of the property, Land Solutions. I just wanted to say that I would ask you to vote in favor of the project, and also I wanted to speak to the credibility and honorability of the developer. And if a lot of people are resistant to change, and we all love a green space and the way the land has always been and for years, but change is inevitable. And if it's not this developer, it's going to be another one that might not do as thorough a job. And I would like you, with any considerations you have that you think they're not meeting now, to consider to work with them as opposed to just declining the project in total. Thank you.
Thank you all. Adam Sager, 3035 Heartland Lane. I also work for Dale and Associates. I am a civil engineer. That's what I wanted to address. That's why I'm here. I actually design these floodways and floodplains. I survey them. I work with the Army Corps of Engineers, City of Franklin, FEMA, all of these people. I have gotten numerous of these flood maps approved, revised, all of this. I know how they work. And so I'm not here to jump in the middle of the politics of all this. I can understand people's frustration. I just wanted to clear the record that if somebody's house floods today and we do nothing and then the rains come again, it will flood again. And so I'm not here to doubt anybody's concern about floodplain floodway. In May 2010, my house was also affected. I totally get it. I understand the fear. I understand everybody's fear about floodplain. I don't understand the reluctance to make it better. And when a developer comes in, I understand there may be things that people don't like about the development, but when a developer comes in, they create more floodplain storage, which would actually make the floodplain better, despite maybe a lot of things that have been heard. Barge has done the study. I know them. They're a very well-respected firm. Steve Casey has verified it. I don't know of a more respected floodplain engineer in Middle Tennessee. If this development were to go forward, and if it is built according to adding all of this storage, I would argue that it could have a benefit for the community rather than a detriment, but again, I understand people's concerns and fears, but that's all I wanted to speak on. Thank you.
Hi, my name's Ann Grover. I just moved to Franklin 6 months ago. I stand before you today because I don't want to be part of the problem, and this is a problem. The city staff memo dated April 7th, 2022 for the April 26th BOMA meeting are clear that the rezoning and development plan are both dramatically not consistent with Envision Franklin. Therefore, BOMA cannot approve it. The rezoning and proposed development are not consistent with Envision Franklin. The zoning ordinance requires a rezoning to be based on this criteria, whether the proposed rezoning is consistent with Envision Franklin. Of the 233 acres, only 17% are above the floodplain in this conservation subdivision design concept. I have a little thing that I made. So this is the conservation the conservation subdivision design, and then this is the plan that goes over it. It's more than 50%. Envision Franklin conservation design concept contemplates as little development as possible with the preservation of floodplains as a direct public safety purpose and to help minimize property damage from flooding. Envision Franklin has two components for conservation design. Disruption should be limited to preserve function and form. 48% of the floodplain is disrupted. 22% of the floodplain is filled for development. This is not a limited disruption. What it intends is that 50% of the new development to occur where the second design concept applies. Instead, this development plan is 35% in the buildable design concept and 65% in the floodplain conservation use concept. This is the first time since the adoption of Envision Franklin that a development plan has not met this guidance. Thanks.
Good evening. My name is Joey Wilson. I live at 1773 McAllen Drive in Brentwood, Tennessee. I was born and raised in Franklin, and our family has lived here for five generations. I've seen lots of change to Franklin in my lifetime. Fortunately, the change has been positive, and Franklin has grown in an aesthetically pleasing direction. I'm a professional engineer and surveyor and serve as the president and CEO of Wilson & Associates based here in Franklin. I've personally been involved with Brownland Farms since 1996. When the Anderton family hired us to provide them with their initial floodplain surveys. Back then, the latest available flood map was published in 1988. In 2019, we were engaged by Land Solutions Company to provide topographic surveys for Brownland Farms, and the latest floodplain map for this survey was published in 2016. In 1988, the floodplain maps were created based on less accurate data than today. They lacked larger global models, and global data sets did not exist. In 2016, floodplain maps could rely on highly accurate and consistently repeatable GPS data, photogrammetric data, LIDAR data sets, and globalized models of streams. From 1988 to 2016, the floodplain and floodway had changed significantly around the Brownland Farms. In 1988, the floodway did not cross Brownland Farms. Fulton Greer Lane and the subsequent shopping center did not exist, and Macatcher Parkway had not yet been constructed. By 2016, Hillsborough Road had been reconstructed and widened. Fulton Greer Lane and the subsequent shopping center had been built. Macatcher was complete and the floodway crossed Brownland Farms and the Everly property just west of Monticello. Brownland Farms has been under development since 2019 and has undergone several iterations with input from the City of Franklin's planning and engineering staff. Associated flood studies for this project have been created by competent engineers, and peer reviews have been conducted on those studies to provide additional levels of quality control and assurance. The developer and their engineers have met and exceeded the city's request, and as such should be allowed to move forward based on the sound engineering data. The only constant we know today is change. We can't move here and hang up a no vacancy sign for future development. Franklin will continue to grow. The City of Franklin's government has some of the best and most restrictive regulations for development. If they say this project meets the requirements, then I urge you to vote yes to approve this project.
Thank you all. My name is David McGowan. I'm president of Regent Homes. I've been building homes in Franklin
since 1988. We've built in Forest Crossing, we've built in Fieldstone Farms, we've built in West Haven, and we've built in Berry Farms. We pride ourselves on building the attainable builder. We don't build multi-million-dollar homes. We build townhouses and condominiums and duplexes that young people can afford that move into the city to come to work. And so if you go out to Fieldstone Farms, there's actually a fire chief that purchased a condo out there a couple of years ago. If you go out to a couple of the neighborhoods, we got policemen that purchased our homes. And so when you look at this particular community, what are we actually doing? If you dig down into it, and we're going to actually build some condominiums out there, what price point are we trying to hit? We're trying to hit about a $400,000 price point. How many people in Franklin would buy a $400,000 condo? I can tell you there's a lot. There's a lot of school teachers that would love to be in one of those condominiums. There's a lot of different service people who work for the city would like to be in there. There are over 60 of those condos planned on this particular site. On top of that, we've got duplexes planned in there. And the duplexes, I believe, are around 24 of those. Again, those duplexes, we hope to be in the $500,000 price range. And then we go into the three-story townhomes that we plan to build out there. The three-story townhomes we're currently building over in the Nolensville area right now, those are priced right at $500,000 to $550,000. How many people in Franklin right now would buy one of those? I can tell you, it'd be covered up with buyers. In addition to that, we were planning on building some smaller alley-loaded single-family homes on the 40-foot-wide lots. So we have contracted with Land Solutions to hopefully buy 150 of those lots. And we want to bring what we call attainable houses to Franklin. The other thing I'd like to mention is that when we build in Berry Farms and we build in West Haven, do we do mitigation? Of course we do mitigation. There's mitigation in all kinds of ways, whether we put pavers down to be able to collect storm water and store it over a certain period of time, or we actually move soil out of one area to create a detention pond or retention pond or rain garden, whatever you want to call it, to be able to meet the city standards. You've got an excellent city staff. I can tell you, anytime we are involved in any kind of building in this city, they make sure we do it by the code. I can assure you that that city staff of code officials and engineers will see to it that Brownlin is done according to the code.
You again wrap up.
The bottom line is there's mitigation and it will be able to be accomplished. Thank you.
I still have John Michael and Adrian Ward and Tom Brannon that have turned in cards. Do they intend to? Okay. And Adrian Ward, same thing. And Tom Brannon. Well, I'll leave the development group how they want to come up. How do you want to handle that, Mr. Estes?
Mr. Mayor, there is some disruption on this side of the room, and it's when it's not the proper etiquette, I think, that we need to have in this auditorium, and I'd ask the gentleman to please refrain from that kind of behavior. And Mr. Mayor, if you would please support that.
Mr. Phillips, if you can't conduct yourself according to our policies, we'll ask you to leave. And if you can't conduct yourself by policies, and I'll be glad to go ahead and have you escorted out. You're welcome. You're going to go ahead and leave now, or I'm going to have you escorted out. Which is your choice? Okay, Mr. Estes.
Good evening. My name is Kevin Estes, 2925 Berry Hill Drive, Nashville, Tennessee. And if you don't know me by now, I don't think you will know me. First, I'd like to thank everyone here tonight. You know, we've been doing this for 3 years now. And it seems like we learn something new all the time. You know, we came to second reading last year, and we found out, even though the FEMA maps have been in existence for years, that they just discovered Hillsborough Road and Matcatcher flooded. So, yeah, as engineers, sometimes we need to look closer. We came here tonight and started off with a slide I have never seen before, and I have been personally asked by the staff to provide everything we can submit to you, and was told they would do the same to us. So as always, we get to discover new stuff the night of on second hearing. I think that's going to be a tradition. And the slide, if you considered area, we're right in line. The amazing thing I thought about the slide is Chadwell was a rezoning. And no matter how you slice and dice it, or what you want to say, rezonings have to be meet the new rules. That's the point of a rezoning, which means they meet the new general plan. And to say, well, floodplain didn't exist before, but it does now, guess what? In 2003, there was no floodways cutting across Brownland. There are now. Do we get to a do-over? Of course not, and we wouldn't ask for it. Brownland has been impacted, and you have all this information in front of you, but you have the 2016 maps and the 2003 maps, where site one was 80% in the floodway, not just floodplain, floodway. And I have zero against site one, nothing. The whole commercial development where Zaxby's and Stroud's, and I cannot name all the businesses, but there's a bank and gas station, was in the floodplain, and the floodway cut across Fulton Greer Road. When 2016 came, magically, those floodways were about 200 foot thinner, and now they're cutting across Brownland, and now they're cutting across the Otherly property. Okay, that's the hand we're dealt. It's not the hand the Andertons were dealt when they bought the farm in 1950, but that's the hand me, the developer, is dealt. And I live with it. I accept it. I've never complained about it. There is so much fear out here, and I'm so empathetic to it. If you lived on Meadow Green and your house was built in the 60s, you are deep in the floodplain. You're not just in the floodplain. You're in the floodway. If you live in Cottonwood, guess what? You were built in the 60s. You're in the floodplain. The very first map made by FEMA produced for the city of Franklin was 1977. You couldn't even get flood insurance in America before 1968 until Congress passed a law. And then the city and county had to volunteer to join it, which happened in 1974 here in the city of Franklin. There's a lot of properties in the floodplain. Is it because the engineers didn't know what they were doing? No. We didn't have the technology or the science. If you're in Fieldstone Farms, I would be the most upset. Guys, in 2010, at this stage of the Harpeth, we did not have a 100-year flood. We came with 80 inches of it. I'm sorry if I'm mousing dry. But we did not have a 100-year flood. If you're in Fieldstone and flooding, it's going to get worse. And you know why? Because you didn't do a flood study. You didn't even have an engineer review it. You had a professional hydrologist, which they don't even exist anymore. FEMA back then cut flood cross-sections every 1,000 feet, 500 feet, not what we do today. There is so much, and this whole, you can't zone this because Envision Franklin says no. I've never been more disappointed in my 30 years as an engineer zoning that you would ever be, or me, put in a us versus you situation. Envision Franklin's a policy. It's a good policy. It's not a bad policy. But the floodplain conservation's a line they turned on. The parking lots of Harpeth Hill, of Christ Community Church, is conservation. the parking lots of the commercial is conservation. It's because it's where the floodplain line was. I hear all these people talking about the engineers don't matter, that 17% of our property is out of floodplain. How much percent of our property is 6 inches in the floodplain or 2 inches? 20%? I went to staff 2.5 years ago and asked for a land plan amendment to stay out of the floodplain and talk about this, and was told it was not part. And now, tonight, 2.5 years later, we want to talk about policy and floodplain. God, where was that conversation 2.5 years ago? We would love that. Is this the best brownland plan I could ever come up with? I don't know. I'm sure I'm not allowed to be very creative at this point. 3 years later, I've been wiggled here, shuffled there, stuck here. Good Lord, I don't think I could move in the box I've been stuck in. But no one, I want no one to fear about their flood. If you decide tonight to move this past second reading, I would ask you to defer to the third reading until the CLOMA was approved by FEMA. That way, there is surety. That way, we can put this to bed. My guess is I could go out there and ask for one house in Brownland, and I would have the same number of people coming up here talking about policy. And I'm going to close on one thing. This staff has talked a lot about planning, never about the engineers. Your staff has high-quality, excellent engineers, and we're talking about engineering stuff for the most part. All the people you heard tonight have talked about floodplain, flooding, concerns about floods, new rains, intense rains, access. I would ask all the aldermen to ask the city engineers, who we have worked with extensively for the last 2 years, those questions. Because if I was a planner, I wouldn't know them. That's not my disciple. That's not my discipline. But an engineer can answer engineering questions. This process is not unfamiliar to the city. You just did it last year with your park. You just took and disturbed 100% of the floodplain of that park, filled in the floodplain, removed volume, and did a study. You found that study acceptable. The same person who did that study did mine. You signed the community acknowledgement letter, you sent it to FEMA, and FEMA approved it. It's going to be a fantastic asset to this city. It's a great thing, and I'm proud of the Southeast Park. We'll be there and serve all those people. But it's the same process, the same thing we're doing. The difference is the city staff has made They have determined that active play fields is passive, because active play fields are not allowed in Envision Franklin. Otherwise, they'd have to say the city park violates Envision Franklin. But since active soccer fields and football fields are passive in their opinion, it's okay to go and destroy all the floodplain. Floods don't know these are soccer fields. They have no idea they're soccer fields. Water don't care. You're still doing the same thing you did as we are at Brownland, but it's okay for you. And it's that process was good enough for you. That policy is good enough for you. I am not angry, and I don't want to sound angry, and I appreciate the staff. I really do. I think you have a great staff. And I appreciate all the people here tonight, and I appreciate them exercising their freedoms. I am merely asking that you think about how the city conducts its business for itself, that you think about where we started and where we've been and what all, and you've seen the massive amounts of changes to these plans, and just listen to the facts and the experts. Because, and one gentleman said, good, if you're not going to listen to the engineers, then answer the question, who are you going to listen to? If all of a sudden you don't like your heart doctor, who are you going to listen to? Who's the next guy up? Thank you, and thank you so much for hearing me out.
Thank you, Board Mayor and Alderman. Mayor, after me, there are two others that would like to speak. I'll be very short, brief. Board Mayor and Alderman, tonight, In front of you is a plan that reflects my client's willingness to build consensus with you, city staff, as well as the community. The plan has a wide mix of housing, great community, open space areas, improvements to the environment. It is a plan that is better today, better tomorrow than it is today. We believe that this is the right plan and the best plan for Brownlin. The density of Brownlin, as proposed, is 1.5 homes per acre, which is the lowest density in a Franklin neighborhood in a long time. The master plan is designed to, in keeping with the design principles of traditional town planning, and the open space ensures pedestrian-friendly access to amenities, walking trails, and parks. The plan, as proposed, complies with the floodplain alteration regulations and the stormwater ordinance, as well as the zoning ordinance. The stormwater ordinance permits floodplain alteration and requires the compensatory cut be at a rate of 150%. This regulation is a significant benefit to Franklin. This improves the function of the floodplain and improves the ability to hold flood waters. It's not a negative. This is a very good policy that Franklin has. It's the highest in the state of Tennessee for compensatory cut and fill. So Brownlin exceeds the minimum. Brownlin is proposing 187% compensatory cut and fill. Brownlin exceeds the minimum standard that lots have to be at the 100-year flood elevation, and instead we're proposing lots at the 500-year flood elevation. That exceeds the standard. The finished floor elevations of residential in Franklin are required to be at 3 feet above the 100-year floodplain. We're proposing to meet Metro Nashville's standard of 4 feet above the floodplain elevation. These standards exceed the requirements and are not the bare minimum. These standards were not and have never been applied to other developments in Franklin where flooding exists today. We're raising the bar. I'll turn it over to John Michael.
Good evening, board members. My name is John Michael, the Thompson Burton Law Firm here in Franklin, 6100 Tower Place. Two key topics to address. The first you've heard some about tonight, but to give extra clarity to the question of the emergency access that was included as one of the conditions for the BOMA consideration for this project, we're achieving that emergency access through the improvement of Fulton Greer. I want it to be very clear that doesn't come at the expense of the city. That's not tax dollars. That will be development dollars used to make that improvement, achieve the needed emergency access, and make sure that we have that added degree of safety that benefits not only this project, but also the assisted living facility nearby as well. Hopefully as many people as can make use of it if the project is approved as designed. So while we had previously negotiated with certain members of the family that were part of the ownership group of what we referred to as the Site 1 property, that's something that the majority of those folks are not interested in pursuing, and that's totally fine. Mr. Welch has told you correctly that his group doesn't want to do it, so we've stopped trying to pursue that, and instead we'll be relying on what we have presented to in conversations, the city's engineering group, and receive favorable commentary indicating that the Fulton Greer solution is in fact just that, a solution for the emergency access. The second point is more appropriate for perhaps the attorney of the group to talk about, and that is the ongoing discussion of the zoning code, the city's ordinances more broadly, and the general plan. The general plan is created here in Franklin under the name Envision Franklin. Just like in Nashville, it is the Nashville Next Plan, and in many other municipalities, it's relied upon to be a guide for future development, for future growth, for future maintenance of the city as it tries to be healthy in its progress over the next roughly quarter century. Typically, 20 to 25 years is the life cycle there. It is a guide. It is a resource. It is not law. To say the plan doesn't meet the development plan doesn't meet the general plan may mean that there is a question about whether or not the cut and fill question is in play, whether or not conservation areas are being overutilized for the development. Those would be fair questions. Fortunately, the development plan that you presented, and I know that all of you have had plenty of material submitted that you've seen this, meets those plans. Does it include a mix of housing stock as specifically sought by Envision Franklin? Yes, it does. You've heard quite a lot about that tonight. Does the plan, in fact, meet the environmentally protected features associated with good development under Envision Franklin? Yes, it does. You haven't heard as much about that tonight, but some still. Now, with regard to the floodplain, why is this area in conservation? Well, John, of course, because of the floodway, because of the floodplain, and our desire to keep structures, development in general, but structures specifically, out of those areas, especially the floodway. How many houses will be in this plan, in this neighborhood, in the floodway? Zero. Anybody in the room tells you otherwise is either politely mistaken or a darned liar. How many houses will be in the floodplain or at floodplain levels if this plan, as presented to you, is fulfilled and constructed? Zero. Mr. Gamble just gave you specific descriptions of how this will be 4 feet above floodplain. I live along the Harpeth, not in this area, not in this stretch of the Harpeth, but rest assured, my house is not 4 feet above the floodplain at that location. But I have something that was built back in the 90s, and many of the people in this room have had that same experience. We make the best of it. We size up insurance costs, but we don't necessarily get the guarantee that this project has of 4 feet above floodplain. So if the issue with conservation policy on certain places of the development has to do with floodplain, but we're building well above the floodplain, all at once we're not really having the same conversation that was presented at the beginning of the night, are we? Objectively, we're not. We will meet, and we have shown you in writing with engineered plans in letters that we will meet every provision of the zoning code, everything from density restrictions, bulk regulation restrictions as far as height, setbacks, etc., and most notably the stormwater management ordinance. It's imperative that we do so. Nobody's fool enough to try to put together a development project anywhere in the city of Franklin, anywhere near the Harpeth River, and not fall all over themselves getting the water management right. 3 years in, a mountain of engineers in, all these discussions in, they've done that. They've done it exceedingly well. I would be interested to see any project that's come to BOMA in the last couple of years, certainly post 2010 even, that would meet these kinds of engineered standards for residential developments. You are asked to consider three circumstances or criteria when considering a zoning change. We've talked a lot about it has to meet Envision Franklin. The law says you have to consider or give consideration to Envision Franklin, your general plan, and that's true. Have you, the BOMA members, considered the general plan on this project? I'm guessing you have woken up in the middle of the night considering the general plan with regard to this project more than once. I have, and I'm not even in an elected position like you guys are. I'm not city staff. So I know that you've considered it. Congratulations. Now the question is, having considered that, having considered the second criteria with regard to health safety concerns, which our engineers have addressed, what for you must be ad nauseum, having considered all of that, you're in a position to vote on the rezoning. You've now considered those things. Box checked. So vote however you see fit on the zoning. I humbly solicit your support for the rezoning. Then on the second piece, the development plan, my client, Mr. Estes from Land Solutions Company, has talked about the prospect of if you need to defer that to a later date to wait until you get the Clomer approval back from FEMA, that's probably reasonable. It's one more arrow in your quiver of certainty, and we're happy to fire that one if that's what needs to happen. At the end of the day, you know we meet law. You've read it, you've heard it, you don't need to hear me say it, but I'm up here to do it one last time. We meet the zoning ordinance, we meet the stormwater management ordinance. This fits within Envision Franklin because we're gonna build up out of the floodway, of course, but more importantly, even out of the floodplain. That's where you have the leg to stand on, the hook to hang your hat on, and know you have a well-engineered project that brings many needed residences to Franklin at a time when there are so few available and helps the city grow in a prosperous way, in a safe way, and in a smart way. We humbly respect all the work you've put in, including staff, and we request your support for both the rezoning and the approval of the development plan.
Thank you for the chance to talk. I'm Adrian Ward with Barge Design Solutions, and I currently serve as Barge's flood mitigation subject matter specialist for the company. And we were the ones that developed the hydraulic model. And we built a lot of hydraulic models, obviously for residential developments, but also for critical facilities, hospitals, wastewater treatment plants, even nuclear facilities, those sort of facilities that can't be allowed to flood. Not that we don't make mistakes, but we are used to dealing with models that are critical to performing well. And so we're confident in this model. This model actually came to us in good shape. It's a pretty new model. Lots of times it'll come in a PDF form. This is an actual model. A lot of money's been put into it before we even got it. The hydrology, I've heard a lot of people talk about increased rainfalls and things like that. If you look in your flood insurance study for your county, it shows that the Harpeth River model was actually taken and calibrated to three recent events. Now, recent for stormwater is still pretty old, but 2004, 2009, and the May 2010 floods were all used to calibrate the hydraulic model. So we're pretty confident in those hydrology results, and those hydrology results developed by the Corps were used to feed in this hydraulic model. And then we modified it as needed for the development to show the existing and proposed conditions. So I say that all that, we're confident in the model, and we're confident that it meets all of FEMA's requirements. Thank you.
Did I miss anybody? I don't see anybody. I'm going to declare the public hearing closed, and I would ask for a motion to recess for 10 minutes.
So moved.
For a bathroom break.
Second.
Is there a second? All in favor say aye. So be right back. Okay, if everybody be taking their seats, and we're going to get started again. We're still on item 7, and the public hearing has been closed, and I'll entertain a motion. Alderman Brown.
Mayor, I move to deny the request to rezone the property known as Brownland Farms.
Appropriate motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Alderman Peterson. Alderman Brown, if I might, I'd like to make a few comments before you do.
Yes, sir.
So, and I'd really like to address policy and procedure of the city. Appreciate all the input from our citizens and also from the applicant. I have a lot of concerns. This thing's drug on for way too long for projects that come to the city of Franklin. We do have a set of ordinances and standards that guide an applicant through the process in a predictable fashion, and we've worked hard on that process. In fact, we have a Development Services Advisory Commission that works to make sure our processes are good, efficient, predictable. Envision Franklin didn't happen overnight. It happened over about a 3-year period of time. And it's very unique in that it is linked strongly with our zoning ordinance. And I'm not sure that any other city has done that. And I don't think that the people that wrote those documents did it by accident. I think they did it on purpose so there would be teeth in some of what we have in Envision Franklin. You know, no question that Brownland Farm property is a very difficult parcel to develop because of the floodplain and the circuitous route of the Harpeth River. You know, I've visited out there. I've listened to the developer. I've worked to understand as best I could what they're talking about as far as the floodplain. And I see that we've had 3 different engineering groups look at the engineering exercise to see about manipulating the floodplain. And certainly on paper, it looks like what they're trying to do is effective. But I have concerns because I don't know how we, you know, I think you've heard tonight that we can't really predict how things are going to continue to change. You know, we've seen these atmospheric rivers recently that are dropping large amounts of rain in one area. Also, the Harpeth River is a living river. The course of the Harpeth River is not the same today as it was last year or the year before, and it'll be different next year. I'm concerned that if we approve this project, we're going to have a whole flood of similar projects with a lot of floodplain manipulation. I have some concerns with our meeting of March the 22nd, 2022, when the board received a memorandum about 3:00 in the afternoon, and staff did not receive that memorandum. I don't think that's the way we like to do business. I didn't think that was very professional. In fact, I found it a bit insulting to staff and also our citizens, because of that. As a board, we should insist that applicants stay with our process and give the same professional courtesies to our staff as we do the developers. And we work hard to make sure our process is predictable, timely, and we should look at projects differently whenever it takes that long for a project to come through. You know, I'm not familiar with any other projects that I can remember that started out with 700 plus homes, went to 400 something homes, and now we're down to 300, and that raises a red flag in my mind. There was talk of elevating Hillsborough Road. That's a state route. That's not a cheap thing, and I would hate to put the residents on Hillsborough Road through what they've been through waiting on Mac Hatcher Northwest and all that happened on Hillsborough Road. And I even have some questions about if we're starting to elevate Hillsborough Road, what does that do to the floodplain?
Thank you very much.
This is a significant policy deviation, and I'm concerned it has a long-term implication for our growth. If we believe this is the right thing to do, let's go back. Let's go look at the policy and not just cherry-pick projects like this. Let's figure out the policy. I think Mr. Stuckey made a good point. We have significant financial policies in our city, and that's why we're a AAA-rated credit. We follow those policies. We don't have to develop every square inch of Franklin, and we don't have to shoehorn a project in a parcel, but rather we should make sure that that the land dictates what goes there. Brownland Farms is a very special piece of property, and I think it deserves more personally. Staff's told us it does not fit in Vision Franklin. And I have great concerns that it does not necessarily do anything to protect the health, safety, and welfare of our citizens. So I'll yield back to Alderman Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'm going to share some thoughts I prepared in advance, and then I want to address a couple of things that came up during the applicant's time as well. A lot of time has been spent talking about the significant manipulation of floodplain and the unpredictable implications of a plan that proposes to do just that. And rightfully so, and after all, we have the responsibility to first and foremost ensure the safety and welfare of our residents. It's also one of our core approval criteria. But there is what I believe to be another responsibility of this board, which we haven't talked much about, and that's vision. To paraphrase a quote from Jurassic Park, everyone's been so distracted with what could be that we haven't been discussing what should be. In order to earn our place here, each one of us at one time or another shared our own vision for Franklin with the community. And now that we're here, we have the responsibility of upholding that vision as well as representing the vision that our residents have for our community, even as captured in Envision Franklin. And speaking for myself and thousands of others, this isn't it. You can't have vision without discernment and intentionality. Great brands like our great city stand for something. They have values and attributes that make them unique and excite the people who engage them. Stray off strategy, and a brand can lose its way and ultimately lose what makes it unique. And it doesn't happen all at once, but rather one bad decision at a time. We pride ourselves in setting and keeping high standards for Franklin and have the accolades and awards to prove it. This plan does not meet the quality bar set for our community. It does not protect an important gateway into our city, and nor does it ensure the long-term public safety of my neighbors, which I pledged to uphold when I took my oath of office. Proverbs 29:18 says, "Where there is no vision, people perish, but happy is he who keeps the law." I'm going to continue to stand behind Envision Franklin, the Planning Commission, the city staff, and the community with regards to this development. And I'm also raising my hand to help be a part of bringing forth a better vision and a less invasive plan that benefits the landowners, the city, the county, and all of our residents. There's a popular adage that states, if we stand for nothing, we'll fall for anything. Let's not fall for this plan and instead stand for a bigger and better vision for our great American city. Now, a couple things I want to make sure that I address in addition to that is that, first of all, let me just say this. Franklin belongs to our residents, not FEMA, and I am not okay with passing off our accountability and our vision to them. I think we can handle that ourselves right here. Mr. Estes stated that engineers miss things. He also fully acknowledged that floodplains have changed and they keep changing. I appreciate his acknowledgement of that in support of denying this request. The applicant's attorney also stated that our land use plan and ordinances are like all others and that we can check the legal box. That actually is not true. Our plan and our ordinances are intrinsically linked together. In fact, reference each other multiple times, tying them together in a cohesive document. The other thing to note about that is it's not just consider these things, but rather those things need to be consistent with. Important language that is repeatedly left out of the explanation provided by the applicant. I'll stop there, Mayor.
Anybody else? Alderman Peterson.
Thank you. There's so many things that we can say here tonight. So many. I feel sure that this proposed project has many aspects that make it unacceptable for the rezoning that they are requesting. just to hit a very few points, I want to say that whenever they talk about adding storage for the river, it's virtually nothing. And it's not, it will not help upstream or downstream from them. There's just not enough change there. Also, the parts of it that they have shown to us about moving the actually a floodway channel across parts of this property, I would be very interested to hear from someone how they can just put it, move it over, and have it flow down, I guess, southwest, maybe, from them. But that's just one thing. There, as I say, there's so many that we have looked at, and I was happy to see that the staff had put out this. There is much more manipulation of the floodplain compared to the examples that they put out in their work. There is so much more manipulation on this project than there was on any of those others they compared it to. And the idea that the percentage of in development encroachments, which I hadn't seen till today, was 70%, I think is a big concern there. The other thing that I just was finally able today to look at the city GIS map and look at the new alternate emergency access route. Whenever I drove over there today and then tried to drive on Claude Yates to look to see what this was being talked about here, I couldn't really find anything. So I did go to the city GIS map, and it appears to me that where they're talking about Fulton Greer going across the in front of the county rec center, that is in the floodplain. Whenever you talk about where it crosses Mac Hatcher, that is in the floodplain. And where you talk about it connecting to and going down to Claude Yates Drive, that is in the floodplain. So it does not seem to me that that would be an acceptable emergency access, or we would need to get much more information about that. But as I say, there is so much on this that makes it different from things that we have looked at before. But there's just so many pieces that bring up a concern. So many pieces that bring up a concern. So as a person that was on the Planning Commission, whenever that was recommended for disapproval, and also on the Board of Mayor and Aldermen before all the new people came online, and since then, I have continued to vote against this because I think it is not the appropriate for us and what we have in our books now.
Anybody else?
Yes.
Alderman Baggett.
A few things. First of all, thanks to the public. This is it's very rewarding to get to hear directly from. It's one of my favorite parts, and some people don't like it, but favorite parts is to hear directly from the folks that we ran to represent. It's very important. It's why I believe most of us, all of us, have chosen to do this and take time away from things that we could be doing. It's because of our, I think, great care and concern for the community. And it's for the folks who get up and come to speak at meetings, and we appreciate it. we must trust the science, and great people and great minds can disagree on a lot of things. The city of Franklin did, in the southeast park, manipulate the floodplain almost five times as much. It's already been done and in the process of being done. And that has happened, and all of us, myself included, are downstream from that. It doesn't bother me. I trust, actually, the engineers. I think the city of Franklin made a great decision when we decided to do the southeast park. I believe the studies when they say that there was no upstream or downstream impact. I wasn't on the board then, but I don't think there was this much outpouring of public opinion at that time. So you can trust the science, third parties. Also, as you've heard, Envision Franklin, it's complicated with our zoning ordinance. It really is. It's something we've got to fix, or we've got to refine. We've got to refine it to this point where we are not having in these situations where we have such conflicting situations. Nonetheless, I, over the last 3 or 4 weeks, have certainly been studying this more than anything that has been brought before us, and really on this rezoning, it comes down to the life safety, and it comes down to the emergency access. And there were options presented that would have been more favorable, in my opinion. Unfortunately, the one that is now seems to be the only one left is one that I can't feel very confident about. And I can't imagine coming out of Brownland, taking a right, taking a left on Fulton Greer, taking a right by the rec center, crossing through a gate, across Matt Catcher, across to Franklin High School, around Franklin High School parking lot, take a left on Hillsborough. I can't imagine that. I'm lucky enough, I live on 96, and I can hop up on 96, 500-year floodplain, and I can get out. So when I look at this first condition, I mean, as much as I do think that we have a lot of refining to do in how we develop floodplain, I am a high critic of how City of Franklin addresses floodplain issues. I think we can be smarter in how we deal with floodplain and still be safe. And I think the staff knows that about me. So that's where I've fallen. And then finally, at some point, you got to represent your constituents. And it's been pretty clear to me kind of where the constituency falls on this, both mine and others. And I am with Matt when he says there's something. I believe Brownland will ultimately be developed in some way. I hope it is. I hope there's something there for the community. I hope there's something there that can pair the things that we love about Brownland with also development of some type. And I look forward to seeing that and seeing the character and seeing us first address Envision Franklin with how getting this middle ground. What we've got these developments that we've done before in the floodplain, and there's this 9 houses and 10 houses or whatever that we've allowed. But our hard line now is don't do it because of what. So there is a gray area. What is it? It's not written down. We need to write it down. We need to say what is appropriate and what is not, and not just this one house is fine, 10 houses are okay, and have it be subjective. I think we need a little bit more guidance or either stick to just nothing, but I also think that's not smart because there are certain situations like the front part of Brownland that could be infilled, I think, with safety. So I appreciate everyone reaching out. I do have to disclaim that I'm a member of Christ Community Church, but it did not affect my ability to look at this in an impartial way, in a way that I think my constituents want me to vote.
Alderman Potts. Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. First, you know, I'd like to thank everybody for being here. It is late. I asked a question at the very beginning. I said, what's been one of the longest meetings we've ever had? And somebody said 10 o'clock, and I've kind of surpassed that now. So I'm going to try to keep my comments very brief now that I've alerted you to that. Sorry. Start on a really good positive here. I did sermon to Matt or Alderman Brown. I captured, you know, notes before the meeting, and so I want to share some of those with you. And then I captured some notes during the presentations tonight. First, I'd like to thank all the Franklin citizens that have communicated their opinions and their personal experiences and related resources through emails, text messages, voicemails, and in-person conversations. I greatly appreciate the passion that so many have demonstrated for our great city. The manner in which the large majority that I communicated with were polite and respectful. I want to thank you for reaching out to me in such a professional manner. And I'd also like to add this. I received over 125 emails. None of them were templated, for or against. That shows individual perspective right there, and that is key to helping us make decisions as we look at all of the resources from staff and experts, etc., but hearing your opinions as well is important, as well as the other resources. Next is, and the mayor touched briefly on this, is recognizing that we are almost 3 years into this proposed rezoning and proposed development. I see an opportunity for policy and process improvement to ensure that our property owners, developers, and those doing business with the City of Franklin have clear process expectations and timeframes. We need to be intentional and strengthen our zoning and development policies. I specifically look at this right now because as we go through joint work sessions and we talk about Ward 3 and what's along the I-65 corridor, that's always sensitive to me. And so when I looked at Brownland Farms, I look at it through the same lenses. So I want you to know that. Mr. Mayor, I want to thank you for taking the time and sharing your thoughts here at the very beginning. And I agree that Envision Franklin is linked strongly to our zoning ordinances. It has to have teeth. And as Mr. Stuckey, our city administrator, mentioned to us as well, we are in the great place that we're in because of policies and procedures. There are rules and regulations. Our kids are taught rules and regulations, rules to play on the field. You can't do this, otherwise it's a penalty. You can do this and you can score, right? We're teaching our kids those things. We have to follow rules as well. And when we don't like the rules, then you work to have them changed. I've sat up here before in front of this board and been the only person that voted against a rezoning because I didn't think it was right, and I'm working to have that changed. So if we see a need for change, having this public outpouring like this and having all of these great individuals here that are volunteering their time, this is how we continue to make positive change. In all transparency, similar to some of the other aldermen, I have visited and invested time at Brownland Farm, met with the developer, met with the designers. Likewise, I've met with the executive director for the Harpeth Conservancy. I have read numerous reports. And I will go ahead and share with you right now, prior to being elected, I sat in those same seats right there. And I watched the previous BOMA board, choose not to send this back to rezoning and planning. And when I sat in that chair, I thought, I think it should have been done different. That's my position on it. It should have gone all the way back to the beginning, let them start back over, and start where it should have been. And I see heads nodding and some people agreeing. And so I'm glad that others were thinking that as well. I think that we do have to develop. We have infill that needs to be done right now. And we have to do it with smart conservative growth, and we have to match our policies accordingly. So as I look at this, and I have sought counsel from our legal department as well as far as our Envision Franklin and how everything ties together. And we do have to look at, you know, whether the proposed rezoning is consistent with Envision Franklin and the purpose of this ordinance, whether the proposed rezoning will protect the health, safety, and welfare of the public, and whether the proposed rezoning corrects an error or meets the challenge of changed conditions, changes in public policy, or changes necessary to advance health and safety and welfare of our city. These are our policies. These are our rules. We teach our kids to follow the rules. And in this case, we need to follow the rules. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Anybody else? Alderman Berger.
Well, I came prepared with a lot of different comments tonight. And first of all, I just want to say to Matt Brown and to Jason Potts and to Patrick Baggett that on this board, and Gabrielle, you're new too, so I don't want to leave you out, but you haven't spoken yet tonight. You haven't been on the board very long. And one thing about this board, since I've served on it, is we will vote. Some of us will vote opposite from others, but we all walk away and we shake it off. Mm-hmm. And we're still friends. And we still work together. I think we work together very well. We have good leadership at the city most of the time. Sometimes I'm beginning to wonder here, since we've been 3 years in the making with this, and this should never have happened that way. But I want to say to you three gentlemen, thank you for doing the job you're doing, because even if I may agree or disagree with all the points or some of the points or whatever, you've done a great job. You're doing wonderful work, and I can't not say my comments tonight without actually commending all three of you for that. You've thought this out well, and you're representing the people well. I too want to represent my people well, and the city, but I have a lot of problems with this thing, because I think, and then the mayor even brought it up too tonight, but he said something about we got something very late on a date, right at a meeting that we should have had before, weren't expecting it. But the city's at fault as well with that. We were at a second vote, the 11th hour, when we found, oh, wow, we have got water on Hillsborough Road, and there's a problem here. That came late in the game, should never have come late in the game. These things can't be missed. They're detrimental to the health of our community, but they're also detrimental to our staff, our timing, our tax dollars that we spend on all these things. So we have some things to fix, I think, at City Hall in some ways. And I'm not here to throw our city administrator and our attorneys and our staff and everybody under the bus, because it is what it is. It happens. These things happen. And we sometimes get in a quagmire, and sometimes it's, you know, everybody's fault, all of us collectively, maybe even BOMA for not asking the right questions at times. And that's why we rely heavily on the expertise of the engineers and Steve Casey and Barge. You know, thank you, because I believe your studies. I believe your studies. And I think there's a lot of hype. I think there's a lot of fear. There's a lot of friends of mine here in the audience that you've conducted yourself fairly well. Some of you have been a little off the charts, but I would say the fact that, and it's an emotional issue as well, but we will have to agree to disagree on some of these things and some of the ways we've gotten here. But bottom line, I had all these notes prepared. I'm not going to bore you with them, because there's so many things to be said. So many things to be said, and maybe I'll write it and put it in a blog just so I can get it off my chest to say it. But I think bottom line is, Mr. Mayor, you said something about the red flag of having seen 2, 3, 4 maybe developments. Well, what if these people all go away and this property gets developed, or somebody wants to develop, or Mr. Casey, you want it, or Mr. Estes, you want to develop it still, and you come back with another plan, is that another red flag? I hope it's not. I hope we don't get ourselves into this. We'll be hell-bent on letting anybody do anything on that property. These people have a right to sell their property. So why have we gotten 3 years down the road to this point? I put a lot of blame on our city. I put a lot of blame, and people may agree with me. They may not agree with me. We may walk out, and we may wrestle with this for a while. We may be mad at each other for a while on this point, but we should never have allowed it to get to this point. This gentleman, I asked the other day how much money you have into this, about $2 million. He walks away with $2 million. because he's tried to make a development. These people tried to sell their property. And I know there's a lot of things that go into all this. And again, I want to reiterate, I'm not trying to say that our staff is bad or administration bad or BOMA is bad. We are not intentionally, hopefully not intentionally, doing things like this to drag out processes, because I think we're pretty sick of it too, going through it and through it and through it. And I thank you all for coming out. I thank you for speaking. And I just want to say that, I think it was the attorney that said, we have a lot to sort out here. We have a lot to think about. And you're right, we do. And I think in the end, it is what it is. And I think that hopefully the Andersons can sell their property. And I would say to all of you and other people that have weighed in on this and all the emails I've gotten, they want it to remain a farm. They want it to be open space. Let's have a community-wide GoFundMe, raise money, and buy this property. Because the city sure isn't going to buy it for $24 million or whatever it is. Because we just bought land down to do a park, and an inclusive park along with that. A lot of good things happening in the southeast that has no park. And we have Harlandsdale right down the road, a mile down the road, with an equestrian element there, big equestrian element. So it's not, it wouldn't be something I think the city would do. I'm not willing to raise taxes to do it, that's for sure. But I understand all your points, and I really appreciate all of you sharing, especially Ms. Mayor as well. And Eric, your points are well taken as well, and a lot of this makes sense, and a lot of it doesn't make sense, because we got to start. Why do we ask the developer or the applicant to do a study with engineers and hire a good firm, and then the city require a third party that we make you pay for, any developer pay for, and then we just sort of, no. So many people got up and said, you can't trust the engineers. Well, sorry, guys. Went to school, got master's and PhDs in your disciplines, but we're not going to listen to you. So I have a problem with that, too. So I think we've, I'm tired of dissing on the experts, and I'm sorry about that. I think those are most of my comments. I have a boat load of stuff I could say, but I'll leave it go. Thank you.
Vice Mayor?
So many great things that have been said. Patrick, I agree. Envision Franklin, it's funny, throughout its life, it's been a guiding document, and now it's hooked. I don't understand how we always make modification of standards to something. And yes, I understand that's going to happen, but it needs to be looked at again. And with all the zeal that y'all put in sitting in this room with your yellow stickers and Lord, the emails, and yours were professional. I had some threats, and I don't appreciate that.
Yeah.
That's not Franklin. Mm.
Mm. Yep.
Threats are not good. Okay. Threats don't win friends, they make enemies. So, sorry, it's late. Yep. I've always said in the last 11 years I've done this job, absent public opinion, I will vote my gut. 9 times out of 10 is absent public opinion, because it's all about not in my backyard is when you get people to stand in this room till 10:30 at night or send emails where they're bulletproof and they want to point fingers. Robin Anderton and his mother Sissy and his father are good people that have built up an industry in our community that was no longer at Harlandsdale, and I hope that y'all would recognize that. He may not have Midnight Sun or a statue there, but it's been a difference maker that keeps our community, the rural aspect that you have come to appreciate as part of who we are. So I go back to, there's been a lot of sensationalism in this campaign, and I say that's happened in the last several weeks. We all got to believe somebody, but one of those videos that I saw was like, save Brownland Farm, we don't need the horse thing to go away. It's their farm. If they want to move it, it's not about what affects the community. That's just one example of the sensationalism of what we're really dealing with. I do believe that it will be developed someday. I do believe they need that opportunity. I do believe we need to fix Envision Franklin. But I will tell you again, and if it goes on my tombstone, I'm fine with that. Absent public opinion, I have to vote my gut. Well, you all are sitting here, mm-hmm. and you are the people that elect us to this office, and that's what our job is. So if you want us to keep hearing you, keep showing up, but be a little nicer when you do it, and realize that the person you're opposing is a person too.
Amen. I'll say it back to
me. Amen.
Alderman Barnhill.
Well, Mayor, I'm going to suggest that we put that 2-minute rule in on us.
Remember that, guys. Remember that.
Hey, 3 years later, we get
you know, a lot of things have come up tonight, and a lot of issues have come up, and some of those issues, flooding and following the Envision Franklin zoning and whatever, they're legitimate concerns. And I've heard, sitting in here tonight, I've heard even the applicants say that there can be some mistakes as far as the professionals are concerned. And if that's the case, then no one could be 100% sure that there's no harm done by this project. And I've always asked, anytime we've asked, I've asked whoever's at the podium, does this cause any harm? Is there any downstream or upstream to this? And the answer has always been no. But you're sitting out there and you're saying to yourself, I doubt it. I wonder. I experienced something. And we've all experienced some flooding. And I can tell you something. Flooding is in Franklin is not unique to the last 2 or 3 years. If you go back and look at some of these, you look at a flood in 1975 that closed Hillsborough Road and Franklin High School and wherever it was. So it's not unique to this particular time. But I do think that there's enough concern and enough energy in this that it makes it difficult to support the project. And I don't think it necessarily conforms to Envision Franklin and that locking horns with the zoning ordinance together. So we'll go from there, but I'll make a suggestion to the mayor on the 2 minutes.
I was timing you, Clyde.
He's got 10 more seconds.
All you had to do was ring the bell.
Alderman Hanson.
So I have a couple of questions of staff, actually. Engineering. So we have the hearth assisted living on the other side. Do they have alternative escape routes at this point, or are they challenged?
They're currently challenged by that 100-year flood event.
Would the proposed improvements to Fulton Greer or this path be an improvement for the hearth should the developer move forward and correct that?
It would certainly help that area, yes. There were some other things that went into the development of the hearth. I think I'd have to ask. I was going to ask Andy to come up, but there were other items that went into the development of that to help protect it. But yes, during a flood event, it would be challenging to get there today.
And do we have anything that proves or disproves upstream or downstream effects from this development?
Repeat your question.
Is there anything that we have as a city that shows that there is no effect for upstream or downstream from this development?
Based on current modeling, it's not been formally submitted to the city. It would happen actually afterwards, but we've had the third-party consultant vet it. And then once, if approved, they would finalize that model, and they'd have to comply with our stormwater ordinance, which states there could be no upstream or downstream impact. So they would help to verify that. City staff would then sign off, and then FEMA would also do an additional review of that for additional quality control.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
So obviously we've had some safety concerns before, and as far as safety's concerned, we had some improvements to that road. It would not only assist people that were maybe living in the Brownland development, but people who were living in an assisted care facility or those close by. It's a challenging area at best to work with. I do agree that it's not necessarily conforming with Envision Franklin, and it's time for that revision, and it's good that this is a revision year. And I do appreciate each of your contributions as we go into those discussions. One thing that was not discussed at all tonight is the impact of additional parkland that is being created by this Brownland development. There's going to be 3 miles of greenway that's for the first time ever publicly accessible on Brownland, which does lend to open recreation for the public, better mental health for being outside, a kayak launch into the Harpeth. Some things that didn't get discussed, something that's, as a horse person myself, that's been concerning is the enormous muck pile, because I know what happens with horse muck. And it breeds parasites, it creates all kinds of other insects. I know, I muck stalls. I know what lives in the muck piles. And it has been large. I'd love to see that removed. I don't know if there's any incentive to really fully break it down if there is no development there. My concern is really the ingress egress in case of a flood. You know, it's like getting in the wrong lane at the grocery store. If you don't build it, it'll never flood. If you do build it, it will flood. There's just no right or wrong answer. It's really hard, and the public has been very kind in the way that they reached out, both in support and both against the development. And I do appreciate you being very tempered in your response. It's greatly appreciated. And I do see a lot of challenges. I see equally as many benefits, a more affordable housing component. But I too have sold many homes in floods, in flood zones, and seen clients' homes flood. I'm fortunate mine did not. I've been hit by a tornado, but never a flood. And I know it's real. I know the loss is significant when you see pictures you can never replace, washed away forever. It's a significant impact. So don't think that I didn't listen carefully and didn't weigh it all out. But I do have some safety concerns about the ingress egress, even if we did improve it, and how long it would take to improve it.
Okay. Anybody else?
I do have. I'd like for Paul to come back up just for a second. Paul, I don't know which is the biggest issue here, whether it's flooding or whether it's the Envision Franklin. But on the flooding, if we were to defer this and require them to send their plans to FEMA for approval, and have FEMA's approval also, besides all the engineers and besides everything else, maybe I shouldn't even ask if that's your opinion. In your opinion, would that eliminate some of the flooding concerns? Maybe I shouldn't put you on the spot. Maybe you shouldn't answer whether or not. I'll answer that. I would think that would eliminate some of the concerns if you had all the engineers and FEMA also entering into this before we approve second reading tonight, that we defer this for 2 or 3 months. They then get their plans to FEMA, see if they're approved. If they're disapproved, it's over with.
As it relates to the review, what I've been told is our third party did a much, much more thorough review than FEMA would actually do.
Okay.
They did an extremely thorough job reviewing this. And again, the results would have to comply with our stormwater ordinance, which are no impact upstream and downstream. And typically that's not done until after that development plan has been approved by the board, is when we go through that process.
Go ahead.
So that would be the third party review that we'd have to go to.
So Steve Casey with CEC is our flood expert. Right. He would be the second party or third party review doing it. FEMA would be then the final review.
But the engineer studies that we have all told us that it improves the land. We require it to improve the land 150%, and no impact upstream or downstream. And that's what we've heard. Is that what we understand to be true?
Yes, that would be the requirement that they have to meet to move forward.
That is absolutely the requirement. I'd like to make a comment about that after they finish.
Yeah, I just wanted to know, because we've done these studies, we've had the engineers weigh in, and they're telling us this. So I just...
Yeah, that would be the requirement.
I was confused.
And really, it's a FEMA-built model. It's built by, it's done with FEMA and the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. They're simply manipulating the in-between sections of that existing model.
Alderman Peterson, well, and I'll go to Alderman Brown after that.
Okay. I just want to say that, you know, I have never gotten anyone who was any of the people that looked at this tell me that they knew about another place that was kind of completely encircled by the river. And also, I would love to ask some questions about how does, in addition to finding out another, I don't care, it doesn't have to be, certainly not in Williamson County, but in the state of Tennessee, where they have had something where the river is situated just like this. I mean, completely encircling the area, and find out about one of those projects, and have them have us have a chance to find out more about that, number one. And secondly, you know, I had some questions about how are they talking about being able to do some of these things that they discussed on changing, you know, something that was a floodway and moving it to another part of the floodway. I mean, there have been a lot of things that I would like to learn more about the studies and everything, but I've never gotten an answer. And I asked from the very first, give me an example of another project, and I don't mean water's edge here. I mean something where a river is doing what this one does, and then getting a response from any engineer about any of that. So I don't think, I mean, I think there would be a lot to it.
Yep. Alderman Brown.
Mr. Mayor, I just would like to say, I think it'd be a travesty to our community to defer this and to push further a three-year discussion on a plan that clearly is not supported. The reality is we could debate old data, we can debate deep channel versus shallow flood. There are so many aspects to figure out. I realize we may not like the criteria that exist, but the reality is, and you said it well, our Envision Franklin, our land use plan, and our zoning are tied together to give them teeth. We did something progressive that other communities haven't. And for that, we should follow it. If we want to change that, we're coming up on the opportunity to do that. But today, that's what exists. And I think to continue to kick this can down the curb, to ask more questions, to develop on a land that's 70% manipulated, a plan that nobody wants, would be a travesty to our community. And I hope we can just put an end to this tonight and see what great things can come of it in the future.
Ready to vote?
Yes, sir.
What we're voting on is a motion by Alderman Brown and seconded by Alderman Peterson that to deny the rezoning of this particular property. So we'll start with Alderman Peterson.
I'm voting yes to deny.
Alderman Hansen.
Yes to deny.
Alderman Barnhill.
Yes.
Vice Mayor.
Yes.
Alderman Berger.
Yes.
Alderman Brown.
Yes.
Alderman Potts.
Yes.
And Alderman Baggett.
Yes.
Passes unanimously to deny the rezoning. Sorry, please don't. Item number 8 is a public hearing concerning resolution 2021-53 approving a development plan for Brownland Farm PUD subdivision for several properties located near the intersection of Hillsborough Road and MacArthur Memorial Parkway. We have to have the public hearing, or?
I mean, you can open it up, but you can't actually approve a development plan without a rezoning. So
we would ask for a motion for it to be.
I
Remove?
You can make a motion to deny it because it's moot. That's probably the most prudent.
Well, I have no one wanting to speak to this particular item, so I'll close the public hearing and ask for a motion to deny to the development plan.
Mayor, I move to deny the development plan for Brownland Farms.
Second. Second by Alderman Barnhill. Any discussion? Ready to vote. Alderman Baggett.
Yes.
Alderman Potts.
Yes.
Alderman Brown.
Yes.
Alderman Berger.
Yes.
Vice Mayor.
Yes.
Alderman Barnhill.
Yes.
Alderman Hansen.
Yes.
Alderman Peterson.
Yes.
Plan is denied. Next is a public hearing, a resolution approving a revised development plan for Christ Community Church for the property located west of Hillsborough Road and south of Harper River. This also is mute, and I have nobody that wants to speak to this, so I'll close the public hearing and ask for a motion.
Motion to deny.
Appropriate motion by the Vice Mayor. Is there a second? Second by Alderman Potts. Any discussion? Ready to vote. Alderman Peterson.
Yes.
Alderman Hansen.
Yes.
Alderman Barnhill.
Yes.
Vice Mayor.
Yes.
Alderman Berger.
Yes.
Alderman Brown.
Yes.
Alderman Potts.
Yes.
Alderman Baggett.
Yes.
Passes unanimously to deny. Item 10 is City of Franklin Contract 2021-0045, Parkland Impact Fee and Construction Agreement between the City of Franklin and Miles River Partners, also known as Brownland Farms. I would entertain a motion to deny.
So moved.
Second.
Appropriate motion second. Any discussion? Ready to vote. Alderman Baggett.
Yes.
Alderman Potts.
Yes.
Alderman Brown.
Yes.
Alderman Berger.
Yes.
Vice Mayor.
Yes.
Alderman Barnhill.
Yes.
Alderman Hansen.
Yes.
Alderman Peterson.
Yes.
That's denied. Item 11 is Resolution 2022-24, resolution authorizing the city administrator to approve agreements in the use of condemnation if necessary to acquire rights of way and or easements for the Old Paytonville Road and Long Lane Bridge and Connector project. Is there a motion?
Mr. Mayor, I'll so move the motion.
Second.
Thank you, Alderman Hansen, for that prompt second. Any discussion? Ready to vote. Alderman Baggett.
Yes.
Alderman Potts.
Yes.
Alderman Brown.
Yes.
Alderman Berger.
Yes.
Vice Mayor.
Yes.
Alderman Barnhill.
Yes.
Alderman Hansen.
Yes.
Alderman Peterson.
Yes.
Passes unanimously. I would entertain a motion to adjourn. Thank you.
And second.
We took that up earlier.
Okay. Second.
Seconded by Alderman Berger. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
We are dismissed.